I'd like to call to order the June 19, 2012 meeting of the Planning Board of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. The first item on our agenda is the minutes of the previous meeting. Do I have any comments or questions on the minutes? Carol Ann?
On page one, in the second paragraph that begins Amy Bell Siegel, I would like to change or clarify in the second sentence. It currently says, she said at the last meeting, they propose a single lot on a 2.32 acres lot. I'd like to propose we change it to, the last meeting, they proposed a lot for the current homestead of 2.32 acres, to make it a little clearer on what she said.
Okay. Yeah, do I have a second for that?
Yep.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor? All right, carries unanimously. Any other comments on the minutes from our last meeting? Okay. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes?
Motion to approve the minutes.
By Victoria, a second? Peter, any discussion? Favor? Great, thank you. In case I forget to mention it at the end of tonight's meeting, our next planning board meeting after tonight will be our regular July planning board meeting. As is our tradition, there will be no workshop meeting in July. Just wanted to make sure folks were aware of that, unless some kind of unexpected emergency comes up between now and then and we choose to have a workshop, in which case we'll give notice, but generally we will not have a workshop in July. The first item on our agenda is new business, Golden Ridge Subdivision Amendment. Golden Ridge LLC is requesting an amendment to the subdivision approval granted October 18, 2011 for the Golden Ridge Subdivision located on Golden Ridge Lane to replace the donation of an open space easement with the payment of an open space fee, Section 1625, amendment to a previously approved subdivision.
Thank you, Chair Fallander, and good evening, members of the board. I think the letter that we submitted along with this application is relatively self-explanatory.
Could you introduce yourself?
Yes, my apologies, Chair. My name is Lee Lowry. I'm an attorney at Jensen and Baird, and we represent Golden Ridge Lane, LLC, the owner of the property. And I think we were here, I know we were here last year before the board on this project with the plan that's in front of you now. And the discussion at that time had to do with whether the applicant would be required to make a grant of trail easements to the town, or whether the applicant, which is what the applicant offered, whether the applicant would be paying the open space impact fee as determined under the ordinance, which is what our client wanted to pay. The board, after taking into consideration the input from the Conservation Committee, elected or voted to impose the easement requirement. Subsequent to that meeting, we then came back to the board for asking a reconsideration of that condition of approval. The board didn't entertain that. Our only recourse at that point was to proceed with an appeal of that specific condition in the Superior Court. That didn't go far. Fairly early in the process, the town's attorney reached out to us and asked if we would be prepared to resolve the matter based upon payment of the open space impact fee in lieu of the granting of the easements, the trail easements, to the town. I don't want to necessarily go into the legal arguments about the trail easements. I'm not sure that that's necessary, but we're happy to discuss that if that's the board's wishes. I think our letter sets out that chain of events, and we're simply part of the resolution, if you would, of the appeal with the town in court, was to be certain that we came back and had the board approve the plan as originally presented last fall, which is what's before you now, It includes no trail easements to the town, but it does include the requirement of the open space, payment of the open space impact fee for two new lots. And on that point, just to clarify our letter, Maureen O'Meara kindly pointed this out to me. It's actually, this plan is technically the creation of two new lots, not one new lot from what is currently the approved plan. So I would be happy to answer any questions the board has about that. We're kind of hopeful that we can get this resolved and that our client can move forward and undertake his improvements.
Thank you. Unless the board has any initial questions, as we do in all matters, I would propose to go ahead and have a public comment period on this request. So if this is not a formal public hearing, but it is our opportunity to hear from members of the public. So if there is anyone here who would like to speak to this matter, please come forward. Seeing no one, I will close the public comment period. Do I have any questions from members of the board? Peter.
There was a question, I believe, on the ownership of the plan. There was a letter from Freddie Flaherty and some mention of fees and whatnot. Has this been resolved?
Not to my knowledge. Has this been resolved?
I'm not handling that on behalf of Golden Ridge Lane. They're represented by other counsel with regard to that. The situation with regard to the plan is that there's a dispute over the amount of fees owed, not the ownership of the plan. And this is actually the plan that was front of the board last year, and the reason in talking with your counsel he was comfortable having this plan presented is because it's part of the public record that's already been presented to this board. And so irrespective of the dispute about the fees and the use of the plan, it's appropriate to be in front of this board. And my client fully understands that he needs to produce a Mylar of this plan sealed and stamped by an appropriate civil engineer or licensed surveyor, perhaps both. So that's certainly his intention, understands that that's a requirement of the board.
I guess I have a couple of concerns with that. The town is now on notice that this plan cannot be reproduced or used in any way without the consent of Mitchell and Associates. And the plan says that on its face. We're now being told in the letter that I have specifically that they haven't authorized the use of it. I think we actually have a new condition that has to be added to the plan as part of our approval. On the other hand, this is not the forum to litigate a dispute between a landowner and one of their contractors, but I'm not completely comfortable giving an unconditional approval and then coming in and putting my signature on a plan when we have noticed that the applicant doesn't have the right to present that plan to us. So I'm not exactly sure how to proceed on that. And I guess the other thing is, I believe that before this dispute arose, the town manager concluded that there was adequate financial capacity with a $12,000 debt outstanding. I wonder if that needs to be taken into account in concluding adequate financial capacity, particularly when this application requires some significant road construction. So I don't know if you have any suggestions, Lee or Maureen. I think the suggestion that we simply go ahead and sign a Mylar of this plan is not something that I'm personally comfortable with. So I don't know what our other options are. Perhaps if we're inclined to approve this, that we approve it subject to the condition that we get a document from Mitchell and Associates withdrawing its objection, or a formal legal opinion from our town council, which I understand we don't have. although you and he may have talked, my understanding from Maureen, we did not have an opinion from him that we could proceed. So I think we and you are kind of stuck by this letter.
Well, I think there are two parts of the question. One is the financial capacity of the applicant. With that, in that regard, Madam Chair, the amounts of the bills exceed $50,000. My client has paid over $40,000 of those bills already, and the dispute has to do with the balance and in relation to the work. I don't think that indicates any financial incapacity. It indicates that there is a bona fide dispute about payment. Secondly, the property was purchased, I believe, in 2010 for $215,000 with cash. There's no mortgage on the property at that time. There's no mortgage today. I don't think there's any indication that the applicant doesn't have the financial capacity to undertake the project, simply because there's a dispute outstanding that someone put in the public record, I owe you money. I don't know if there was any even financial capacity requested at the original application. So I think on the basis of an adverse party's attorney's letter asserting, they owe me some money, I think it would be a stretch to find now that the applicant is not qualified financially to undertake. In addition, of course, the applicant is going to have to pay the open space fee as well as provide the performance guarantee before the Mylar can be released. So I don't think the financial capacity is an issue. And I think the normal conditions of releasing the plan adequately protect the town in that regard. Secondly, with regard to the use of the plan, it's a nice letter. I think there's a dispute about whether it's appropriate to be before the board. This is exactly the plan the board approved last fall. As I've said, we understand that we need to produce the same plan certified and sealed by appropriate professionals. And at this point, all we're seeking to have addressed by the board is the condition of approval. So I think it's appropriate to craft a condition, as the chair suggested, respecting or with regard to the need to present a plan suitable for acceptance and signature by the board. I don't think it should be a procedural roadblock, however, to proceeding with the request that's before you this evening.
And are you suggesting that by the time you produce a Mylar, that the objection to Mitchell and Associates will have been withdrawn?
I'm not suggesting that necessarily.
Okay, then in that case, I'm not sure that the plan you're providing to us with that letter outstanding, I don't think with that and a Mylar alone are going to resolve the issue. I agree with you that we can proceed tonight with appropriate conditions, and I appreciate the explanation on the financial capacity issue. We didn't know whether the issue had to do with a dispute on the amount of fees or simply a non-payment of fees, which could indicate a different financial status. So I appreciate that explanation. That's very helpful on that part of it. But I remain concerned about our proceeding with a Mylar of a plan that requires the permission of Mitchell and Associates when we have a letter that says that you do not have that permission. I would not feel comfortable signing that plan.
Oh, I understand. Please understand. I'm not suggesting that we would simply take the plan, produce a Mylar with no seal and no signature by the surveyor, Northeast Civil Solutions, and Mitchell Associates, and present it to you without their approval for signature.
Okay. Okay.
No,
as long as we've got
understand.
That approval.
I understand.
Okay. All right. Anybody else in the comments?
But if, sorry, real.
Start down there.
I took the letter to be saying, and I appreciate hearing your reaction, that because of the claim of Mitchell Associates, you essentially do not have the right at this point to submit the plan as part of your application, as you have. As a matter of Maine law, do you have a point of view on that?
I think it's actually a matter of federal law. It's copyright law. I don't have an opinion on it. This is a document that's already in the public realm. It's in part of your public records.
Well, beyond the copyright claim, beyond the, I appreciate federal law as the copyright claim, but they seem to be asserting some kind of a right to keep you from using this plan in addition to the copyright issue, and I'm just having no idea at all. Could I hear your side of that case?
I don't have any opinion on it. I think, as I said, I had the conversation with the town's attorney, and we talked about, he had received the letter, he understood what it was saying, and his view, and I felt it was legitimate, was that this plan, which is part of your public records, can legally or lawfully be presented to this board once again.
Anybody else down there? Liza?
I have no problem with inserting a condition that Mitchell and Associates consents in writing to the use of the Golden Ridge subdivision plan, but I'm just wondering if we should add on some language about a substitute plan.
Just so to have
a different engineer.
That's fine.
So that the applicant doesn't have to come before us again if they don't resolve their issue with Mitchell and Associates and they pay a different company to make the plan. But so I've crafted the some language about the Mitchell and Associates plan, but I'm just curious, maybe Maureen or what other people feel like about adding some additional language about a substitute plan.
I would think unless that new person actually went out and redid all the work, that new person would not be authorized to use any work from Mitchell and Associates in producing that plan. So I think that's an unlikely expenditure for the applicant to make. That would probably be more than resolving the dispute. But
I would disagree, Madam Chair. My client has told me and authorized me to tell the board that if they do not resolve the Mitchell dispute, then he will pay for a licensed civil engineer, whatever the requirement is, to go out and reproduce the work. He understands that that would be the requirement, that it can't simply be a copying of the plan, and they would reproduce the work and produce their own work product and plan.
In which case, I would think we would have to see it.
Absolutely.
We would have to review it, so I don't think,
I don't think
we could approve that tonight until we had
seen
it.
We're not saving any work.
Yeah. I understand.
So I think either we present this plan as, you know, with the consent of Mitchell, and technically what you'd be being presented would be a sealed and stamped, you know, signed and stamped plan. So you'll know it would have that Mitchell Associates and Northeast Civil's consent because it would be their signatures on it. And if we have to if he has to pay to reproduce the work, he's prepared to do that.
Sir, I'm puzzled. You received the letter over a month ago. Has anybody talked to Mr. McVeigh? Has there been any chance to? I mean, I don't think the board wants to get in the middle of this apparently messy situation, but it is what it is. Has there been any discussion with representatives of the Mitchell firm?
I can't report on conversations. I'm not representing Golden Ridge with regard to the dispute with Mitchell.
And I assume that
I would say Mr. McVeigh didn't call me either.
Is there a representative of the applicant here who might want to illuminate us on that or not?
No.
No. Okay.
I wonder how we can be asked to make any decisions or any information about something that's prohibited from our domain. It says here, prohibition of use without consent. So even if you accept in some way this and say it has to be okay, it's specifically prohibited here to even mention it. So I think that there's a problem there about which comes first.
I guess I'm personally comfortable with saying that this is a document in our own public record so that it's kind of already our document to look at in terms of looking at the plan and saying that we're one to come back properly sealed with the same information, we would allow it. I don't know, perhaps others are not even comfortable going that far.
I don't think it's appropriate at this time, to be honest with you.
What you're doing, I mean, again, this is the same plan that was in front of the board, and what you're really doing is amending, if you will, the condition of approval that was applied by this board as voted on October or September of 2011.
But we weren't aware of this. We weren't aware of this.
It didn't exist at that time. That's correct, yeah.
So really, our comments were based on something that we weren't supposed to be seeing. At the time. At the time we could?
At the time, there was, my understanding is there was no dispute between the applicant and Mitchell Associates at the time you approved the plan in October of 2011. So the dispute has arisen since that time.
So the changes?
Yeah.
Life changes, yeah.
The plan was presented to you by Mitchell and Associates at that meeting, sir. And I think that's correct, Maureen. I don't follow the billing and the paying of the bills.
I don't either, but I have to assume that if John Mitchell was standing here that night, that he was okay with representing the applicant at that time, so.
Correct.
I'm okay with approving it as a condition of approval that this dispute is resolved.
Anybody else
if you're getting a read.
Want to weigh in on that issue, Maureen?
The only thing that occurs to me, and I hesitate to bring it up, that unfortunately, Mr. Lowery, your client has proved he's willing to sue the planning board over conditions of approval. And if you post a condition on here that says that you can't use this plan unless you resolve your differences, you are then opening yourself up to a challenge, a legal challenge on even that condition. I believe that's true.
Well, what if the
But you're asserting right now you're asserting you're okay with it.
I think that Member Quinn had suggested an either-or condition. One was we either resolve this dispute or do whatever to have the plan sealed and signed by the by Mitchell Associates and Northeast Civil Solutions, or we hire another civil engineer to produce its own work and its own plan presented back to the board.
That's what I was going to suggest.
I mean, our goal is to be clear that our plan can proceed without the without the requirement for the pedestrian easements, and that way we don't have to spend time and money continuing with an appeal in the Superior Court of the original condition, which the town doesn't want to do, and I don't think is a great use of time and money. But certainly my client is prepared to spend the time and money to have an appropriate plan redone if that's what he needs to do. It's not a financial issue, and I don't know how strongly I can say it. For him, it's a matter of principle where he's at on both of these issues, and I would like to move him closer to resolution.
Joe, when you said that you were going to make the same suggestion, you also agree, though, that if it's a different plan, anything other than a Mylar of this exact plan, that we would then need to see it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So that's fine.
In one case, we could possibly be done tonight. In the second alternative, you would have to come talk to us again.
Yes, I understand.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Anyone have any comments on the substance of the request as opposed to the procedure? Nope. Okay. Anyone like to make a motion?
I'm going to recuse myself from voting on this.
Okay.
I'll make a motion.
Liza.
Motion for the board to consider. The following motion has been drafted to include the conditions originally placed on the October 18th, 2011 approval. One, Golden Ridge LLC is requesting an amendment to the previously approved Golden Ridge subdivision located on Golden Ridge Lane to pay for an open space fee instead of providing a pedestrian easement, which requires review for compliance with Section 16-2-5, amendments to previously approved subdivisions. Number two, Section 16-3-1Q establishes an open space impact fee as a standard of subdivision review. The standard requires that open space be provided for each new lot in a subdivision. Number three, the applicant is adding two new lots based on the most recently recorded subdivision plan. Number four, Section 16-2-4C requires that the performance guarantee be provided prior to construction or sale of lots. Number five, Golden Ridge Lane is proposed to be private and must be maintained as approved in order to provide adequate access for town emergency vehicles. Number six, the subdivision amendment substantially complies with Section 16-3-1 subdivision standards. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Golden Ridge LLC to amend the previously approved Golden Ridge subdivision and add a fifth lot at the end of Golden Ridge Lane be approved, subject to the following conditions. Number one, the applicant pay an open space impact fee of $8,640. Number two, the applicant provide a performance guarantee to the town in an amount acceptable to the town engineer, a form acceptable to the town attorney, and all acceptable to the town manager. Number three, the road maintenance agreement be provided in a form acceptable to the town attorney, signed by the applicant and recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. Number four, that there be no alteration of the site nor issuance of a building permit until the above conditions have been met, and the subdivision plan has been signed by the planning board and recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. Number five, Mitchell and Associates consents to the use of the Golden Ridge subdivision plan by the applicant and by the town in writing. You guys might want to wordsmith my last condition, but that's all I have. The last one.
Carolyn? Oh, you're second. Okay. Any, Maureen?
I have a request for the board to consider adding another finding of fact. And it might need a little wordsmithing. It would be finding of fact 5.5. The planning board wishes to avoid any accidental violation of copyright or other proprietary interest laws and rights. I am recommending you add that to your findings of fact section before you make your motion, so that there's something in your findings of facts that explains why you've added a new condition number five.
That makes sense.
And I can't make that, but someone else. Thank you.
5.5, pending the planning board wishes to avoid any accidental violation of copyright or other proprietary interest lawsuit, interest, the last word,
laws and rights.
Laws and rights.
I have a second for that.
Could you reread that?
Yeah, sure. The planning board wishes to avoid any accidental violation of copyright or other proprietary interest or
and rights.
Which one?
Laws and rights.
Okay, Liza, do you want to accept that?
Yes.
Carolyn, second? Okay. So, Liza, the motion you made referred only to getting Mitchell and Associates approval. It did not include any alternative for the applicant to return to the board with a plan prepared by an alternative person.
Yes, correct, because I assumed if that were the case that the applicant would have to come before the board, so
anyway.
We may as well remain silent. But if there's an advantage to putting additional language in, we could do so.
Go right ahead.
I think from our, from my client's perspective, it would be preferable to have the alternative plan or alternative set of engineers or engineer included, simply so that we have a clear guidance.
As in, it would be considered as an amendment to a previously approved subdivision or something like that?
I guess I would say that we obtain the consent by, from Mitchell and Associates to the use of the, as you have written, to the use of the plan, to town in writing, or an equivalent plan, well, yeah, I think I would say this, or an equivalent plan prepared by a licensed civil engineer or other required professional be presented, be prepared and presented back to the board for its approval.
But I guess I wouldn't want that as a condition for approval. It sounds like that almost belongs somewhere else, because we would have to look at that.
I understand.
Other plan before we approved it.
I understand. I understand, but it's like a condition that the board would have if your plan in front of you wasn't what was provided back to the board for signature, that you would have once again a relook at the plan that was brought back.
Isn't that...
And so I suppose we run the risk that it's different in some material way, and therefore we've got a whole opened issue.
Isn't that implicit in the condition that Mitchell and Associates has to produce the stamped drawing?
No, I don't think it is. It's implicit in it, if it's left as it is, that Mitchell and Associates must be satisfied, which I kind of find a little unusual. But it's implicit in the requirement of the board that the that a professionally sealed and certified plan is presented, Mylar of the plan is presented.
I have a question for Maureen. Has any has there ever been a case where a design professional has been switched in between approval and creating of the final plat?
I can tell you that we had a situation where we had an approval from the board, and the board was concerned with the clarity of the plans. And the applicant, instead of taking the plans that we had and making the changes that were necessary to meet conditions, actually completely redrew the plans. So it was the same design professional, but it was a whole, I mean, there were 3 plans when we started, and there were 17 plans when they submitted them. So it was a very, very different set of plans, and it was extremely difficult to make sure that what was approved was what was in the plans. So I think perhaps the applicant would be satisfied if it was made clear in the minutes that it's the board's intent that if you do not bring back plans that are have been prepared by Mitchell, that it would be considered an amendment, that you would have to come back to the board and submit them. Because it's not just this Mylar. There are details of how the road is built. And I mean, even
Correct.
One or two of those things could change, and we really need to review it again.
I think that's a fair suggestion.
So, just a note in the minutes. Do we need a formal request for a note in the minutes?
I think we just look at the secretary and say, please make sure the minutes reflect that anything that's not Mitchell and Associates would have to come back as an amendment to the approved subdivision.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the board can make sure that's in the minutes next month.
Okay.
It will be worded.
Okay.
So, Liza, could you repeat the language you had again?
Yeah, and then I will. And I think it could be tighter.
Okay.
What I said, was Mitchell and Associates consents to the use of the Golden Ridge subdivision plan by the applicant and by the town in writing. But I've actually rewritten it, just since we've been talking, to something a little tighter.
I wonder if we could say that the, instead, that the subdivision, the final plan presented to the planning board for signature include an original signature of an original signature from Mitchell and Associates and any other, is there another design professional?
Northeast Civil Solutions, I believe, is also required as the surveyor.
Both signatures dated subsequent to the date of this approval. So,
correct.
A new, clean, original signature from those two design professionals. To me, that language gets us out of saying who has to consent and doesn't have to consent, and gets us back to our requirements, which is that we have a properly signed and sealed plan.
That sounds good.
Does that work?
Yeah, that sounds very good.
Right. And just so the board's clear, we're not presenting a plan that's been signed by anybody. At this evening's meeting, it's not like we presented
right.
a false signature. I don't want that to be misrepresented. There is no signature on the plan.
You're presenting an old
the same plan that the board had. Right, correct.
Right. We are looking again at a plan already in our public record.
Correct.
So I guess my proposed amendment would be that the condition read that the final subdivision plan submitted for signature by the board include an original signature and seal by Mitchell and Associates, and I'm looking for the name of the other person, and any other design professional participating in the creation of the plan, which signatures shall be dated subsequent to the date of this approval.
I accept that.
Yes. No, it's submitted for our signature. Oh, did I say it? Oh, okay.
Could we make sure this, your condition that you just read, be the second to the last condition in the approval so that the...
Yes, that makes sense.
Yeah. Does that make sense, everyone?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So, Maureen?
Yes, ma'am.
So 5.5 comes before?
5.5
5.5
comes
right
here.
Is a finding of fact.
Oh, no, there isn't a finding
there
of fact.
There are no findings.
No, but the 5.5 that Henry read earlier
yes.
is a finding of fact. It's a brand new finding of fact that I call 5.5, so it comes just before 6, which is the subdivision
okay,
amendment. That's findings. And then Elaine's...
You know, I think what she's saying is these are not labeled findings of fact, and in fact...
No, they're not. They're not.
So we need to add findings of fact.
We can do that. Yep. And then the condition that you just wrote would be a new condition, number 4.
Right.
And 4 would become number 5.
Okay. So we would have to add a findings of fact section.
Just be a heading.
I believe that would be what the chair read would be condition 5, and then condition 6 is what Member Quinn suggested. Is that right? Are you suggesting both of those?
I think Planning Board Members Quinn is being replaced by what?
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
Okay, great.
Yeah, and that is now number 4.
Number 5.
And then 5 is the condition that reads that there be no alteration to the site or issuance of a building permit until the above conditions have been met.
Right.
Oh, all right. I see.
I have a question, Maureen. On the actual plan, the note 3 on the plan says that there's no sale of lots until
right.
there's a performance guarantee and the open space fee has been paid.
Yes.
Does not refer to the road maintenance agreement,
no.
which actually is also a condition of the same thing. Do we need to amend this note to refer to the road maintenance agreement, or do we not typically do that?
We don't need to, because this note is a standard note that comes out of the subdivision ordinance for both public roads and private roads.
Okay.
And then the condition that you have that relates to the maintenance agreement relates specifically to this project.
Okay, so we wouldn't need that condition also to be added to the plan?
Technically, because there's a note number 3 on here, we don't need it as a condition of approval, but what I'm discovering is that if you put it in as a condition of approval, the chance that it actually gets noticed is enhanced.
Okay. Great, thank you. So, any further discussion? Everybody clear what we're voting on? Okay, all in favor? Opposed?
Thank you very much.
Victoria, you're abstaining, and Peter, you're recusing yourself. Okay, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in favor, 1 abstention, and 1 recusal. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. I know it's an awkward position for the board to be in, and I appreciate your taking the time to work through it.
Thank you. Well, I appreciate everyone's patience tonight. Clearly, you're all here for the next item on our agenda, which we will now get into. Short-term rental amendments. The town council has forwarded to the planning board for review proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance to regulate short-term rentals, which is the rental for less than 30 days per tenant of a residential dwelling. And tonight we are having a public hearing. For this meeting, Maureen prepared a packet that really itemizes all the changes to this ordinance that we have made as compared to the ordinance that was brought to us by the council's ordinance committee. Procedurally, just to remind everybody, this ordinance started at the town council and its ordinance committee. It came to the planning board because that's a required procedure for any amendment to the zoning ordinance. We conduct our own review, hold a set of hearings, and we recommend it back to the town council. At that point, the town council may indeed choose to send it back to the ordinance committee, and they may again go through their own hearing process. So we're kind of at a middle step here. We've had a couple of public hearings already, and there are very few changes to this ordinance from what we talked about here last month. One change, as is explained in Maureen's memo here, is the requirements that the planning board decided to recommend on the kind of life safety improvements or life safety equipment that must be in a short-term rental. And I will explain briefly what we've done is we have looked at the International Residential Code and International Building Code, which are life safety codes that are already applicable in the town. The portions of that code that would normally apply to a residence didn't seem to quite cover what the planning board wanted to do, so we have added to this short-term rental provision the life safety code provisions that would apply to what seem to be some similar uses for short-term occupancy of other kinds of uses. This is something that has been done previously in connection with daycares, which are also sometimes in a residential type structure. That's a very brief explanation where this came from. Basically, what is being recommended is that smoke alarms, carbon monoxide alarms, portable fire extinguishers, and lighting for emergency egress be required in any short-term rental, and that is part of what the code enforcement officer would be looking for before approving a short-term rental. There's also in the packet tonight, and hopefully you've had a chance to look at it, an estimate from an electrician as to what it might cost to install some of this equipment, and some technical specs for some possible alternatives that someone might use for the lighting and the fire extinguishers, just to give us a ballpark sense of what it means economically for a homeowner to be making these kind of requirements. And I believe, Maureen, all this material is available on the website?
Yes.
So you can find it all on the website. We also have in front of us some new material that was circulated tonight, and Maureen, is this on the website?
No, I just received this evening, and I believe a member of the public is going to be speaking and referencing this, so I, instead of her handing it out when she spoke, I said, just give it to me now, so she's going to reference it when she comes to the podium.
Okay, and then will this appear on the website?
No, but it will be in the public file, so that anyone who wants to come to the town hall can look at the file that has all this information in it, and they'll be able to review it.
Okay. And just very briefly, as the ordinance now sits, it applies to all residential zones, the town center and the BA in the town of Cape Elizabeth. It applies to all lots, regardless of size, as it is currently in front of you. It requires a minimal rental period of 3 days. Nothing shorter than 3 days is allowed. And it includes an exemption for owners who rent their homes for not more than 14 days in any given calendar year. That's the ordinance, that's the document as it now stands. Hopefully that briefly brings people up to date, and unless anyone on the board has a question or wants to add something, I would suggest we start our public hearing. Public hearing is now open, so please come forward if you'd like to speak and give us your name and your address, please.
Good evening. My name is Joe Agnes Pasquarella, and I live at 12 Peebles Point Lane in Cape Elizabeth. My packet is the packet that was given to you earlier. I'd like you to reference the aerial photograph there with the rentals. I have a legend at the bottom discussing those rentals, and I would like to address you with what I have one letter in the packet that I wanted to bring up. Could I do that?
Since this is not something that is up on the screen, can you just briefly describe for the people who might be in the audience or listening at home, the neighborhood that you have here, and we have an aerial view, and just kind of orient people as to where we are in Cape Elizabeth in your picture?
Sure.
Great, thank you.
I live in Peebles Cove. There's 24 cottages or homes, and out of the 24 cottages, six are presently active rentals. I believe there's three there that are occasional rentals, possibly four, meaning that they get rented for maybe a week at a time, maybe four times, five times a summer. So they're not really, I don't know how they do it, but they're rental properties at some point during the summer, but not constant turnover, because the owners stay in them at some point. There's three properties that are very close to Peebles Cove that are also rentals, as you could see, one being the barn there. I call it the barn because it looks so big. And the back house there, I don't know what that situation is, but there are, we have known it to have rentals. And the house next to it, and then the house on the corner of Reef Road. Those are other rentals. And there's one property now that's under construction, renovation, that was a rental, and may or may not be, I don't know, but the owner of that property already has a property in Peebles Cove, so it could become another rental. I do not know if it's going to be sold or not. So may I read my...
Yes, please go ahead.
I reside in Peebles Cove, community of 24 homes. As both a resident and owner of a rental property, which I do own one, I am in the unique position of understanding the problems regarding short-term rentals from both sides. Presently, there are six active rental properties. Three to four others have rented occasionally in the past. In this neighborhood, homes are tightly clustered. Neighborhoods like Broad Cove have large two-acre lots. Peebles Cove has extremely small lots. For this reason, I asked the board to consider different rules to govern the unique problems short-term rentals cause in these tightly clustered neighborhoods. The distance from the back of our house to my neighbor's house is approximately 20 feet. We have been subjected to unbelievable problems and sleepless nights because of rental properties. One evening last summer, we arrived home, the 4 to 6 inch fireworks shells shooting off from in front of my neighbor's property exploding close to our home. These are the size used at public fireworks displays and are quite dangerous. They are capable of blowing a man's head off. The next day, I discovered it was a complete stranger renting my neighbor's cottage, firing these 4 to 6 inch shells. They fire them from the cove up towards my home. In the past, the property abutting us has had runners with dogs that have barked continuously from morning until someone arrived home in the evening. The town's response was, even though the windows were open, the dogs were in the house and there was nothing they could do. We've had to endure renters coming and going and arguing at all hours of the night, our driveway being continually blocked, sexual encounters outside our back windows, bright lights and loud televisions all night long. I even had a man who at 2 and 3 in the morning would chant in Arabic, yell vile, disgusting things about his mother, and throw his cat off the second floor porch 20 feet from my bedroom. I could recite other experiences with renters, but these were some of the most offensive, and I believe they would cause anyone great concern. Recently, my neighbor's light has continually been on all night. New owners had just finished rebuilding. Strangers were coming and going at all hours, and I assumed it was just new people getting settled. I discovered to my horror, the new owner, who does not live in the community, is renting the house for $300 to $750 a night. I defy anyone to tell me you would be comfortable and feel safe in your homes knowing strangers are appearing nightly outside your bedroom. As a rental property owner, I understand the issue for property owners. Make the most money possible and let the neighbors take care of themselves. It is no secret that short-term renters are generally letting down and letting go. That usually means having fun, parties, fires on the beach, late nights, and generally a good old time. Unfortunately, homeowners in this neighborhood suffer the consequences. There should be no Motel 6s in our neighborhoods. By allowing short-term rentals, the town is approving high density and multifamily usage in neighborhoods zoned for single-family homes. We live in residential communities where it is expected, and the zoning should demand that such business activities do not take place. I believe this expectation is the reason people choose to live in Cape Elizabeth. They say you cannot judge another man until you walk in his footsteps. Please walk in my footsteps. If for no other reason than the belief that one should feel safe and secure in their home, I beg you all to take a closer look and a much closer, a stronger stance for the benefit of our children and everyone's safety and quality of life in this community. And I gave you some rentals that are there that I think demonstrate the fact that more than one family rents these properties because of the cost. And thus, we're creating multifamily usage in these residential neighborhoods, not only on a yearly basis, but on a weekly basis. And whereas I can't have a duplex, my neighbor who rents can. Thank you.
Quick question.
Yes.
Where's your rental property? And is it a short-term rental?
Six Boat House. I have a rental property that I always try to rent it. I used to rent it by the summer.
Uh-huh.
I've now put it up for sale. However, when I do rent, I never rent for less than a week, and I try to get monthly rentals at the minimum.
And is it in the neighborhood or?
Yes.
Six Boat House?
Six right there on.
Oh, okay. With the, so it's one of the rentals,
yes,
that you've identified, and it's up for sale.
And in fact, in that house, when I redid it, I could have made two bedrooms. We made one bedroom. And I always advertise it as one bedroom. And the reason I did that was because I wanted to keep it low density.
Thank you. Hello.
My name's Peter Clifford. I live at 36 Lawson Road. I want to echo what I've just heard. I've had that very similar experience within the past week or so. And I live in the Lawson Road neighborhood, which is a very small lot neighborhood, just like People's Cove. It's not quite as small, but it's similar. And I very much agree that the decision to get rid of the 30,000 square foot line, I guess, I think is a mistake, and for that very reason. If you have houses that are very close to each other, the impact of short-term renters, especially people partying, can be disastrous. We had a bachelor party in the house literally next door to us over the past weekend, or I think the weekend before. There were fireworks, there were strippers. I have a third grader. It was deeply offensive. It was offensive to everybody that lives in our neighborhood. We were assured before this by the person who actually rented the property, who is not the owner. It's a person who has sublet the property at I believe it's 32 Lawson Road, as a business, that this would never happen. And within a few days of that promise to me, it happened. So I have a couple of very pragmatic suggestions. I know you've worked hard. I've seen the memo that was crafted today with the revisions. And the suggestions I have are a couple. One is, I think the ordinance really does need to define what a nuisance is. Because right now, if there's a bachelor party, if there's a person, like you've just heard, firing firecrackers, if there's sex, and this happens, and this has happened in our neighborhoods, there's been naked people at the beach at Lawson Road. It's horrifying. There's no controls whatsoever. And with the spread of HomeAway and other websites, it's only going to get much worse. So I think the planning board, perhaps it's the town council, that could do this. But to say drunkenness is a violation. So if somebody's drunk and it's a nuisance and the police are called, the owner gets fined, and it hopefully doesn't happen again. The license is revoked. If there's nudity, if there's all sorts of activities that we would just, using common sense, define as a nuisance, those would be defined, punished, and the license is revoked. So that's an important point. I hope to see it at some point. If this board doesn't think that it has the time or resources to do it, if there is a report to the town council, I hope that is a suggestion, at least that I think many of us in Lawson Road and perhaps Peebles Cove think is necessary. Another important point is, I think if an owner leases his property for 30 days on a long-term rental, I can see the argument that that is a residential use. But when an owner subleases to a person for profit, and that person goes on HomeAway and maximizes his revenue, that is the functional equivalent of a B&B. So I think it's critical that anyone that is permitted to do a short-term rental be an owner who's accountable to the neighbors, to the town, who pays taxes. And the idea of these private people subletting oceanfront properties and then subdividing them to make huge money, $5,000 for properties in our neighborhood for a week, or I think even more than that for certain, it's astounding. And you can make a fortune if you do this, and that's why this problem is being caused. And the more people you have, the better deal it is for everybody except for the neighbors. I think also the issue of density is important. Right now you have a property next to me could have 20 people legally under this ordinance. With all due respect, that's not a single family use. That's a party. That's somebody making a lot of money on HomeAway. There's really no need for it. I think a maximum number should be 10. To me, that's a lot of people for a single family residence. But if you've got a short-term renter, the owner isn't there, people are, by definition, let's face it, partying, you've got to limit the number of people. And we've seen for years in Lawson Road abuse of the privilege of renting your house. So I know you have a lot on your plate. There's other people here. You're going to hear more issues. But I think this board has focused a lot on life safety, which I think is good. But I think if you focus more on nuisance and the other pragmatic properties from a very common sense view of what the problems of the neighbors are, that would help. And I think there's one last point, if I can find it. Yes, the three-day limitation, I think, is just simply unreasonable. I think a seven-day rental makes sense. And here's where I think the 30,000 square foot lot requirement helps. Most of the people who made comments at the last meeting, such as the, some of the folks with really large homes, like the Poole family, they have large private compounds. Why should they be regulated? They can pretty much do what they want because there's no neighbors. I suggest that that 30,000 will carve out many of the people who aren't going to abuse the system anyway. And by focusing on the small neighborhoods where there is a dramatic problem that's really causing some substantially bad effects in our neighborhood, you'll be not regulating what doesn't need to be regulated, cutting loose many of the people who've said, look, I've had a property for 100 years, why should you regulate me? And I don't think necessarily you should if there's no neighbors. But in our neighborhood, in People's Cove neighborhood, this is a major problem. We have kids. There's crazy psychos out there. We send our kids out to ride their bikes, and you're like, you should see some of the people that are renting. It's very scary. A bachelor party with a bunch of drunken bachelors is a pretty scary thing if you have young children. Okay? Thanks very much for your time.
I asked this before. Did you inform the police during your experiences?
Yes, sir. They were called, and
what happened?
They were called. I don't know who called the police. Jenny,
oh, did you personally call the police?
Okay. No, I'm sorry. Somebody did call the police. I think, among other things, there were 11 cars for this bachelor party, and we couldn't believe the number of cars. There are photos that you may see later, but it was the most abusive situation I've ever seen. They started firing fireworks at 11:30 at night and raising hell and shouting on this private beach that is a neighborhood beach, and the police were called.
I understand. What happened when the police arrived?
I don't know. I think my assumption is that things calmed down. I think it did work, but I don't personally know, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Thank you. Next person. Okay.
If you just use the touchpad, it should come back.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Aronson. I live at 27 Lawson Road. Our neighbor is this house, number 31 Lawson Road, and it is now a short-term rental. June 1st, I alerted the planning board and town council about a bachelor party gathering taking place for a long weekend. 10 men drove up in 10 separate cars from Massachusetts. There was loud music, firecrackers, and frisbee and alcohol in the yard. You have received a copy of these pictures, and I will show you the rest of them to the group. Imagine my surprise when another neighbor informed me that number 31 Lawson Road is being advertised on the internet for $1,000 a night or $4,000 a week, sleeps 10. The website includes a lovely description of my neighborhood. I have reviewed the ordinance and strongly agree with the opening statement that, quote, neighborhood residents are concerned that short-term rentals take on the character of a business operating in a residential neighborhood. Yes, these are businesses and require very strict regulation. If my property value drops and the use of town services increases like police, fire, emergency, you can bet the town's going to lose. I would like to change the definition of a short-term rental from less than 30 days to at least greater than 30 days. I differ with my neighbors. I'd like to see small lot delineation added back to the ordinance. Limit of intensity should be much less for small lots. I urge you to keep this moving forward and send it on to the town council. I'll show you the pictures I took the day I came home. I was shocked. That was our street. That's my house in the background. That's a shot from another neighbor's house looking down. That's a cooler with beers on the wall. Men were out in the yard playing frisbee. I didn't take pictures of them. I didn't feel comfortable. I did go up and talk to them. That's what the yard looked like the next day. The property's in disarray. There's no grass. And then I took a picture of every car. They're all from Massachusetts. There were more, and this is actually later this weekend. There have been pickup trucks there dropping off furniture, futons, mattresses. They've been working late at night with the lights on. They're turning this into a major rental for the summer. And it's very scary, not just for children, for anyone. You can see how close my house is to that, sitting out on the deck. I don't want these people in my neighborhood, and I think the town needs to protect us from this. Thank you.
Thank you. Next person, please.
Betty Crane from 9 Starboard Drive. I've been a resident of Cape since 1963, although my first visit to Cape was when I was 9 months old, and every year thereafter till I was 16. And then in 1963, my husband was transferred to Portland, and I was elated because I knew I was going to live on Cape Elizabeth. I have loved this town. I have worked hard for this town. Time and time again, there have been issues that have come up, which I've not been afraid to speak on or against. But I say it again, I love this town. I am appalled at what is happening. I am just sick when I think that this is happening in more than Lawson Road. I'm here because I used to live on Lawson, and I got to know these people, and I've been to the ordinance meeting. Now I find out, as I have said at many ordinance meetings, this is going to spread. It's not just Lawson Road. And we've seen tonight already how it is spreading. So it's up to you people. You've taken the teeth out of the ordinance. The ordinance needed a little more teeth than it had, but you've removed a lot of them. And it's hard for me to understand why you did, but somehow you found it in your heart to do. But I ask you to think it over, to think what's happening to this town and what will happen to other waterfront neighborhoods. You know, it's just not the two that have spoken tonight. It's going to spread. So I plead with you in the name of our wonderful, wonderful town, please, think it over before it goes to the council. Thanks very much for your participation on the board. I understand the hours you put in. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Mallory Marshall. I live at 340 Ocean House Road, right down. I'm neighbors with all of you right here. I've been listening to my other neighbors, and I do think, having lived in the West End in Portland for a long time, that there are problems when you have a residential neighborhood with density, where you can pass a cup of sugar out your window and someone can reach for it and pick it up. You always are going to have problems with people that have 5 teenagers in high school and are having parties at their house during that period. People that have many, many relatives that are coming even from Massachusetts for Thanksgiving, and cars all over the place. But I do feel that Cape Elizabeth deals with nuisance very, very well. I think if you look at our police log and you see the kinds of problems that our police department has dealt with over the last 15 years, you'll notice that there are many, many activities at places like Kettle Cove and other fun night spots here in town. And I think the police have been empowered by the council and by the citizens here to deal with what we all know is a nuisance. Now, so far, I don't think I've ever heard of strippers down at Kettle Cove, but I suppose, you know, I suppose that's something we can all look forward to. We have used our house for many, many events. We've invited countless nonprofits to come and use our 53 acres to, we've had the Garden Club, we've had the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Recently, the Costopoulos family was celebrating a 75th birthday, and they asked us if their relatives could come and surprise their mother and stay overnight at our house for 3 nights and provide her with a unique experience with dinner on the terrace one night and breakfast outside, etc. We were happy to do that. In the past, my children have each had their entire senior class in high school come to our house with numerous volunteer chaperones and spend the night. They all slept right on our lawn and were heavily policed by scary mothers. And of course, our local police department showed up periodically just to flash a little authority. And we've rented our house for a movie. And I made some notes. Our movie involved probably over 30 or 40 people showing up. We went around to all of our neighbors and to the police and to the town council and to everyone to be sure that this was an okay thing to do and to be sure we had the parking for it and there was a control. We had someone on the site at all times, and we'd never had any complaints. I live in another, on another island down in Florida, on a beach, and the use of HomeAway as a tool for people to get through some pretty difficult financial times right now. People who thought they'd have a bigger 401k or a little bit more in their pocket at the end of the line have had to move out of their house and rent it for a month during the tourist season. This is the only way that people in this neighborhood could afford to stay in their homes. They would go stay with children or whatever, and they needed the income to pay their taxes. I want the council to be very careful about over-legislating a homeowner out of being able to afford their home. I think there's got to be a line between what these poor people are experiencing, which is too much, and also too much legislation. And that will be very, very difficult for you. I do agree with the neighbors here that believe that we should support our police and legislate to help our police deal with parking all over lawns. I don't think that's allowed here in Cape Elizabeth, but if it is, you should have to get a permit to do that. If you were having a wedding or all your relatives were coming or something, you should be able to go down and get a permit, and your neighbors ought to be informed that there's a reason there are 15 cars there, and it's probably for Thanksgiving. I think if there are repeated parties at anyone's house, whether it's strippers or rowdy adolescents or just anything that is a nuisance at all, the police should be called, and if you get 3 or 4 violations, then I think there should be a pretty stiff fine given to people that routinely ignore the laws that we have.
I'm going to have to interrupt you for a minute. We do have a 3-minute time window for each person speaking. As you see, the room is very crowded. I want to make sure I have time.
Well, let me just say that it upsets me a little bit that the town at one time was given the opportunity to have, for instance, a historic district ordinance, and homeowners here in Cape Elizabeth said, no, we don't want that. That will infringe on our property rights. So it seems hard for me to understand how this would not infringe on property rights unless you're very, very careful about drawing lines around the rights of homeowners and the rights of scofflaws. And I think these people deserve to be protected, but I think we do too.
Thank you. Next person, please.
My name is Mary Giftos. I live at Six Point Road in Cape Elizabeth, which is on Pond Cove. And that is also the Lawson Road neighborhood. I have been affiliated with a family in Cape Elizabeth since 1968. I bought a property to retire there 4 years ago on Six Point Road. I have put a considerable investment into it. And tried to respect the character of Cape Elizabeth, which I had grown to love in 44 years. It has a unique residential character and history. It is changing. It is now a business community in my neighborhood particularly. And I also have had the experience in the last week of 24/7 people in front of my cottage within 50 feet of my house all hours, 24 hours a day. And it's been quite a shock. But it's a business. I bought a residential piece of property. I invested in the town. I'm a permanent resident of Maine now. This is change. I pay a lot of taxes to live here in a residential community. I do not live in a residential community. I live in a business section. Business is conducted right there. So I respectfully ask that the town of Cape Elizabeth be very clear in what is business and what is residential so that newcomers who wish to live here and wish to invest here and contribute to the town know what they're doing. That's it.
Thank you. Next person, anyone else wish to speak tonight?
My name is David Vole and I live on 17 Lawson Road. First off, I'd like to thank you all for the work that you're doing. It's a bit of a thankless job, quite frankly, and I don't envy you some of the decisions that you're going to have to make. I think in reference to one of the previous speakers, the goals of us who live in the Lawson Road area is not to restrict property rights, nor is it to force people to go into situations they don't like, and particularly with the large lots where there is no interference, no nuisance. Really what we're after is reducing the nuisance factor. I lived on Lawson Road for 35 years. We got to know all of the neighbors back then. It was primarily an old World War II neighborhood, a lot of retirees, very friendly. And then Jane and Fred Armstrong passed away, and their son and our sons and daughter decided that they were going to rent that house out, use it very occasionally themselves each summer, with the idea that that was the only way they could pay off the mortgage and the taxes. Subsequent, and each summer, as different renters showed up, I would make a point of going over next door, introducing myself, pointing out to them our herb garden that they could use, giving them, showing them where the rights of way were, volunteering to act as a guide if they wanted to be shown around, let them use my canoes, and over the past 2 years, I have had to change that because the renters who are showing up, and not just with the Armstrongs, who I love dearly, but the renters who were showing up are literally changing the character of this neighborhood. Years ago, we used to have our kids playing road hockey out in the street. I won't do that anymore. My kids are gone, but there are other kids in the neighborhood. It's really a little bit scary. What's really scary is the fact that the house at 31 Lawson Road is now short-term rentals. The house next door to us, we've talked to the people who are renting it on a long-term basis right now, is rumored to be being sold to another person who wants to put it up for short-term rentals. And I've done a little checking with some lawyers who indicated to me there is nothing to stop this trend. There is no law out there that says that one person, for example, with a lot of money, can't come in and literally buy one house after the other until he's got a carnival neighborhood like Old Orchard Beach. There's nothing to prevent that. Personally, I'm a little concerned. As I understand, some of the legislation here has been put into non-residential zoning, and I can't quite understand how you could have what really is a business. And let's make no bones about it. These places are businesses in what really is a residential neighborhood. One of the things that I've been told is that people really should have the requirement to screen their renters themselves, and that would prevent a lot of the problems. Well, if you're going to do this every week, I defy anybody to really screen everyone properly. And the other argument is that, yes, well, each time something happens, you can go ahead and call the police and the people will stop. The problem with that is we'd be calling the police every week as new renters came in each time. Frankly, the safety factors that you're talking about are wonderful, and I think they help with the safety of the tenants and the people who own the homes, but they do nothing with the problem that exists right now, which is the nuisance factor and the intrusion on our private lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Come forward if you wish to speak. You got one person behind you. You can make a line. Go ahead.
Good evening, Planning Board members. My name is Tilly Kelly, and I live at 96 Breakwater Farm Road, and I'm here representing Sprague Corporation tonight as the vice president, and I'm also a family member. We are concerned about the short-term rental ordinance. We work very hard at our mission of preserving our property in a largely undeveloped rural state. When the town is poised to take steps that make it harder for us to meet our goals, we feel a need to speak up. The Sprague Corporation and Sprague family members have been leasing out houses on short-term basis for at least 50 years. Currently, 7 of our homes fall in this category, and the income we derive is an important contributor to our overall financial picture. It is hard to understand why the town would find it necessary to start imposing regulations on us at this time. It seems an unnecessary and unwarranted intrusion, and I hope that you will instead focus directly on where there may be a problem rather than ensnaring us and others in a web of new town regulations. Please work with us to hold our property together. Thank you.
Thank you. Next person, please. If there are a number of people who want to speak, you might kind of be ready there and keep us moving along more quickly.
I'm almost a little bit nervous to speak because I'm on the other side of the fence here. As a boy in the 1950s, I spent a lot of happy hours in rentals at People's Cove. And 9 years ago, I was able to buy a cottage down there with the hopes that maybe my sons would have it someday.
I'm sorry, we need to start off by getting your name on the record.
Oh, Edward Perry, and I have a rental at 6 Tucker Lane in People's Cove.
Great, thank you.
I look at the ordinance and I listen to the stories that people are telling, and I know from experience with the happenings at People's Cove that I really don't think the ordinance addresses where the real problems are. As a landlord for the past 8 years renting a large building, we can sleep up to 10 people. We're probably one of the largest rental buildings in the town. We've learned a lot of hard lessons in the 8 years, and we feel, my wife and I both feel, that really what needs to be addressed is the noise and nuisance part of the ordinance. It's not so much the number of people you have, it's if they're acting just obnoxious. 5 people can go shoot fireworks off and drink and park in the middle of the road and be more obnoxious than 10 people. The number of people in the building really doesn't address the problem. We do our best to screen renters. We've gotten better and better at it. I can't believe that somebody would rent to a group of young people coming in planning to have a party. I mean, that's our first rule. You're going to just use it as a party place? we're not renting it to you. You lose your deposit if we find out. You lose your $500 deposit at the end of the week if we find out from our neighbors that that's what happened. I really think the way to address this is through a noise and nuisance end of it. If people are running around naked, I can't believe that we're just going to call the police and nothing happens. I would think that you call the police time after time and the message is eventually going to get out. As far as the financial end of this, you know, I look on the website, we're getting rich? I don't think so. There's about an 8 to 10 week summer rental season. If you choose to rent your place in the summer, it pretty much puts you out of business for renting it in the winter. Because the students, we used to rent to students in the winter, their season starts earlier. They have to start renting at the end of August now. So you have 8 weeks to try and make some kind of money that will help you hold on to your building, and it's not happening. Every year, we have more and more blanks in our calendar because more and more houses are going on the market, and the people are trying to rent them, and it's not a big going business that you think. If we let it turn into a casino situation like on Lawson Road, yeah, but I think the way to address that is with a noise and nuisance. It's not saying, well, we're going to have 20 people, and typically we have a lot of elderly people come. They're coming to visit somebody who's not going to be around much longer. They have connections to Cape Elizabeth. They fly in from Los Angeles. They want to have a barbecue in the backyard with Aunt so-and-so, and they have 21 people. Oh, sorry, can't have 21. Can only have 20. And who's going to check on that? It just seems silly. The real way to go after this is with a noise and nuisance. Somebody's drinking, somebody's parking on the road. Let's get them, go after them. Stop it. It's not right.
I have a question. Have you ever taken anyone's security deposit?
Oh, yes.
At a party?
We had, the first year we rented, we hear all kinds of stories. Yes, we're coming here to study for some exam. And what it was a bunch of kids from Bowdoin came down, and they had a party, and we went over there. The first thing we do, the first night they arrive, we kind of walk in on Friday night, surprise them, see what's going on. And they had gone into the woods, they'd gotten wood, they were going to light up the fireplace, which definitely was a no-no. And they never said a word about it. They knew that at the end of the week when they're supposed to get their security deposit back, nope, they never said a word.
One more question. Why don't you just rent it year-round if it's such bad business?
Because now renting a five-bedroom house in Cape Elizabeth is pretty hard to do. Look at all the houses for sale that people are trying to rent. I mean, Home Away is a savior for a lot of people because it's like, wow, I'm going to lose my house. I can't make the payments. I can't rent it year-round. It's too big, or there's too many houses to compete with. When we started, if you looked on HomeAway, there was two or three houses for rent in Cape Elizabeth. Now there's 25.
I think there are 47.
Oh, and 47.
On the whole website.
Good. Any other questions?
I have one. What do you normally charge as a security deposit?
It's $500.
Thank you.
So maybe we should up it, because $500, if you split it with 10 people, it isn't that much. But usually it doesn't get that far, because when you walk over there on Friday night and it's party time. But we've been very good about screening people, and we've had good luck in the past 7 years, I'd say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Julie Armstrong. I live at 32 Lawson Road, and that's not the offending house. I live across the street from the rental. That's 31 Lawson. First of all, I'd like to thank the Planning Board for all its work. I know it has put an enormous amount of time into this, and we really do appreciate it. And so I will be very brief. I know there are a lot of people that want to speak. For starters, I would agree with what some people have said about separating out the larger lots. It seems to me to be inappropriate and really punitive to include large estate-like lots, family compounds, and so forth, when really the problem in this town is in small neighborhoods like our own and at People's Cove.
The next thing, which I think is so important, and I think my neighbor Peter Clifford mentioned, it seems to be really important that someone who doesn't own the property should not be allowed to be the renter. It's one level further removed from accountability to the neighbors. And in this case, clearly there is little or no accountability to the neighbors. As a longstanding member of the neighborhood, I wouldn't mow the lawn at 8 o'clock on a Saturday or Sunday morning for fear of disturbing the neighbors when the renters thought nothing of setting off the fireworks on a Thursday night at 11:30 at night when I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. That was very eye-opening. And I meant that literally as well as figuratively. I agree that the three-day period is way too short. In fact, the bachelor party was a three-day rental. They arrived on Thursday and left on Sunday. And I was the person who called the police because we had a car problem. We had the AAA truck come, and he told us that while his truck was very small, he was able to squeeze through, but there was no way a fire truck would get through. And I thought, that's where I draw the line, and I have never in the nearly 2 decades that we've lived in that home ever called the police about anything like that related to neighbors. But I felt that I really had to do that. Someone asked about what the police did. They showed up and they had the renters move their vehicles all over the lawn of the home. So anyway, I would like to thank you very much for your work. I really hope that this does get moved along to the council. I think we have a huge problem in our neighborhood and it needs to be addressed sooner rather than later. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Hi, Jim Huebner, 13 Kettle Cove Road. I have a short-term rental next door, 11 Kettle Cove Road. I think from past correspondence, you all know how I feel about the general ordinance, so I will not go into a discussion of that, but I do want to focus on one detail, and I should back up. My interpretation of the goals of the whole zoning ordinance changes is to keep Cape Elizabeth neighborhoods with a neighborhood character, avoid events, avoid large, loud parties. Hard to argue with that. I can't, all right? Those are good goals. But with that, those goals in mind, and that's my interpretation of your goals. With that in mind, there's really only one part of the whole ordinance that addresses that, and that's the number of people that can stay there. To me, everything else, all these changes, do not address those goals. For instance, the inspections. How does an inspection and make sure you have egress signs keep a large party from happening? It doesn't. Our insurance carriers require us to have fire extinguishers, smoke detectors, everything else that you put in there for life safety. So it's really unnecessary. It adds paperwork for us, costs us money, and adds no value. Let me give you an analogy. The state of Maine already requires you to inspect your cars annually, right? Everybody's got to do that. All of a sudden, Cape Elizabeth town officials assume, or they feel that the cars in Cape Elizabeth aren't as safe as the rest of the cars in the whole state. So they're going to have a public works mechanic check out your cars one more time to make sure they're okay. You know from experience, you already had it inspected, it's going to pass, but you got to set up the appointment, you got to pay the money, take the time out to bring it over there. It adds time, cost, but no value. Government at its finest. Thank you very much.
What would be your proposal for controlling the parties in the event?
That's tough. I was going to ask the planning board. This is not a rhetorical question. And if you stick around long enough, you will have this on your street. There's a graduation party. There's a beach to beacon party. All right. maybe somebody rents their home out for less than 14 days over the Beach to Beacon weekend, and everybody gathers there and has a big time, cars, those people are not regulated. If that was your neighborhood, and again, not a rhetorical question, what would you do? What would you do if that happened on your street? You had a lot of cars, loud party, it's not a short-term rental, what would you do?
It's different.
What's that?
It's different. It's obviously you talk to your neighbors, but they're the same neighbors next week and next week and the week
well,
after.
I'm the neighbor, I'm right there. It's, well, how is it different? It's a large, loud party, a lot of cars, how is it different?
I'm not going to answer that again.
Yeah, I appreciate, Jim, what you're trying to do here, but this is not a dialogue opportunity. So if you have questions you want to pose, I think we'll have to leave them in a rhetorical nature, and the planning board can then choose to discuss them later.
Understood. And one last thing, I guess I don't have any photographs to put up, but if they were of my tenants, they'd be a couple of them sitting drinking a glass of wine on the porch or reading a book. So I don't have any fancy pictures like that, but that's what it would be. Luckily, I live next door and I keep tabs on my neighbors, on my tenants. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Mary Volin. I live at 17 Lawson Road. When I first moved to Lawson Road over 30 years ago, I could not believe my luck to live near the ocean. It was not long before I realized I was even luckier than I thought. I lived in a close-knit neighborhood where, when a neighbor asked you how you were, they really wanted to know. I remember Elaine Chapman calling me one morning to ask if the baby was sick. She saw steam on his window. I remember George Stevenson politely questioning a contractor who was working at our home while we were away. I remember Betty Crane gathering the neighborhood to help out financially with an uncovered medical expense for one of our neighbors. And I don't know how many times Ken Forjay helped me start our gas generator. The list goes on. Even when my husband traveled, I always felt safe. Initially, I had no family in the area, but I had my neighbors. At the beginning of this process, the planning board put retaining residential character and balance among the ordinance goals. I find the current ordinance meeting neither goal. Without lot size differential, it does too little for small lot neighborhoods and too much in areas where there are large lots, private family compounds, and no problems. Transient high-volume lodging businesses do not fit the character of dense residential neighborhoods with small lots. How does allowing 20 renters, the guest distinction being impossible to enforce, compare with a residential average occupancy of 2? How can adding potentially 30 extra cars be safe for our short, narrow roads? Allowing 10 plus cars to park on a property gives the neighborhood a commercial Walmart parking lot ambiance, not in keeping with the look and feel of a residential neighborhood. How will abutters get fair market value for their homes if they need to sell? Why is this not a taking of my property rights? It seems my only right is the added task of supervising behavior and calling the police. I am disappointed in the outcome of this process, although I really do appreciate the time and effort involved. At this point, I feel the ordinance is so flawed that it needs to be returned to the council for further discussion and action. Several years ago, some friends visited, and as they left, they commented on how lucky we were. Yes, I said, living by the ocean is nice. No, they replied, we didn't mean that. We mean you live in a real neighborhood. You don't find that everywhere. They got it, how valuable true community can be. I hope that ultimately the ordinance will get it too, and how and better protect the residential character of our family neighborhoods. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Anthony Armstrong. I live at 32 Lawson Road. And perhaps I'm part of the friends and family presentation here tonight, but I'd like to give you some of my comments. First of all, I want to thank you, along with the other folks who have thanked you, for all the work you've done, and the council for all the work they've done, because I certainly appreciate this is a very complicated and difficult issue. Just a couple of points. First, I want to agree with my neighbor, Peter Clifford, and others who have mentioned about the need for a nuisance aspect to this ordinance. I think it will address some of the problems that have been very amply described here tonight. Secondly, I think you really have to focus in on this sublet situation. What's happened, and it just so happened to be across the street from our home, but it looks like we've jumped into another era here where the sublet is an official sublet to relet for profit. And that really isn't a domestic or residential use, it's a business. And that's the real big change that has happened here, and I'm sure it'll become a trend, unfortunately. I do appreciate the difficulty some of the folks with larger lots are having with these proposals, and I understand the art of compromise, and I do think that some lot size in the 30,000 square foot area would be a good point of demarcation to exclude certain people when they have larger lots. I happen to be in real estate, and I'm trained as a lawyer, and I'm also licensed as a mortgage banker, so I kind of analyze this thing maybe a little bit more than some people, but I can tell you, particularly from the mortgage banking standpoint, I've run the numbers, and the thing that people are talking about, where you can actually invest in one of these properties and make money and have some time for yourself to use it, is a workable phenomenon in the situation where you've got interest rates below 5%. I just want to make another comment about public safety aspects here. I grew up in 32 Lawson Road. I was born into that house, and I live there today. And I can tell you about safety in that particular neighborhood. I mean, there are two little girls who live in our neighborhood now who come toddling up the street. You know, they're old enough now to have their little car and their dog, and they come up the street. And I remember when we used to do the same kinds of things. We'd go flying down the hill around the corner in front of the 31 Lawson Road, the fairly blind corner there. And the notion that, one, there'd be 11 cars there, like there were last weekend, 2 weekends ago, and that there'd be 11 guys from Massachusetts down there doing whatever they were doing, in this kind of a residential neighborhood is extremely, extremely troubling to me. I think last I'd like to mention a couple of final points. One is you have to think of the property value aspect of this whole thing. I mean, it definitely is affecting property values of those who live across the street. It may be driving property values of those who play the game up, but most other people, it's going down. And that's what zoning is really all about. It's balancing those values and those human values and those property values. I'd like to note also that, at least as far as I can recall, generally speaking, zoning is supposed to be pursuant to and consistent with a comprehensive plan. And I know in Maine law they've kicked that all around, and when you change the zoning ordinance, you're changing the plan, et cetera, et cetera. But the bottom line here is that this is something that really wasn't anticipated and wasn't planned for and really wasn't wanted as part of the town comprehensive plan. It still isn't wanted. So what we're doing here is trying to maneuver around a dilemma, and I hope that you folks will maneuver in such a way that the property values and the values of this town are protected. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening, you guys. Thanks for hearing all of us. I appreciate it. My name is Patty Grennan. I live at 8C Barn Road, which is in the Pond Cove Lawson Road neighborhood. And just to give you perspective, I know you've heard about the one rental. Our small, densely zoned neighborhood has 22 homes, on about 6.8 acres. So we all, the average lot size is 0.31 acres. When Mallory said earlier that you can reach out with a cup of sugar, you really almost can, with a few steps, hit your neighbor. The past 10 years, five homes have consistently rented long-term year-round, with only maybe a couple weeks here and there to make, to pay for, you know, some extra things and for different things. About 4 years ago, this changed, and I think it really coincided with the economic downturn of 2008 and the ease of marketing globally, really, on the internet. And this drove some people to look for other sources of income, and they turned to their homes because it was easy and it was happening. Currently, there are three short-term rentals in our neighborhood. You're only hearing about one, but there are three. And as they said, the two homes that are up for sale, actually the real estate agents have said when they've come to talk to the people that they should consider, because it's a good deal, making their house income-generated rental, short-term rental properties. That's a real option. So that's how they're saying they're going to sell their houses. My house is flanked by two short-term rentals. And just to put this all in perspective, that they rented to as little as eight people and as many as 24, and it would influx with guests even higher than that over the past 2 years. These two properties, over the course of the last two summers, have had over 1,000 people have come through our little backyard. And you've heard last time, it was a public hearing, my husband was here, and he talked about, I think he shared with all the details of the buses that have come through, the weddings, the bachelor parties, the big group events. So I'm gonna spare you those details now. I think you heard them. You have pictures because, and the only reason I've taken pictures is because I was instructed to do so. But this is a dramatic increase in our residential neighborhood over the 4 to 6 permanent residents or owners that used to be in the homes next to mine. Big difference. I suggest that we do need regulation to limit these rental businesses and get some balance back. I'm not just suggesting that we don't let people rent. I'm suggesting some balance. To be more consistent and appropriate, and to have an appropriate use of the single family dwelling in our small lot neighborhood. There's two points I'd like revisited for you to consider that's in the draft, and again, I appreciate your work. Is first, the limit on the intensity or the number of people. I do feel it's relevant, the number of people that come in. With more people come more cars, more noise, more everything. Yes, five people can make a lot of noise and that thing, but you know, it's impossible. 20 people is too many. 20 people allows for small weddings that we've had in the past. It allows for bachelor parties, allows for groups. I would like that number to be more reflective of what a residential neighborhood typically has, which is, you know, 6 or 8 people as a max. I think it's impossible to tell who's a tenant versus a guest with giving just a broad number, and the burden is on the butters to police, and I really don't want to spend my summers counting people, to be quite honest. The last point I'll make is that is to bring back the 30,000 square foot delineation that came from the ordinance committee. You hear from people who are on 53 acres, they shouldn't be included in this. They can have big movie nights and the whole thing. All of us, if we have parties, have to, as owners, have to tell our neighbors and invite them. You only want to focus on, as Mike McGovern said when we first began this process, to strategically and surgically hit the problem and figure out what it is and regulate to that. Do not over-regulate and involve people who don't need to be. And he also said, if you can't, you know, we did decide, if you can't see or hear your neighbors, there isn't going to be a problem. So again, thank you for looking into all of this. I hope that you'll keep this draft moving and pass it on to the town council, and I appreciate all your efforts. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak tonight? Let's make sure, actually, I think just given the hour, I think we still have people who want to speak, so I think that just one time around, we're going to have to stop.
Hi, I'm Sandy Dunham, and I live at 11 Becky's Cove Lane, and I have a cottage at 12 Becky's Cove Lane that's actually on less than an acre. Even though we live down a dirt road and we are the only people down there, so we really can't hear or see our neighbors, but we do have a small lot. And this is the third summer we've rented out our cottage on a short-term basis. Most of the people renting this summer are returning. One family's coming for the third year. In their inquiries, they often say that they're looking for a quiet area to take their family on vacation. And that's generally the type of people that I see looking for a place in Cape Elizabeth. And last week, we had a really nice couple from North Carolina. They sat on the deck most of the week and just loved it. They went to IGA, they went to the Buzz, they, visited the businesses in town. I do screen people as carefully as I can, and I've had no problems. The first summer, I rented to a group of fraternity brothers who were here for a wedding. I was a little concerned about them, but they turned out to be some of the very best guests I've had. Ours is a small cottage, 3 bedrooms, 1.5 baths. We're very concerned about safety of our guests and our property. So we have installed, without being told, smoke detectors, carbon monoxide alarms, portable fire extinguishers, and we even have an escape ladder that we bought when we bought the property in 1979 in Portland. Fortunately, no one's had to use that escape ladder, but it's there. One of the concerns I have about the rules you've come up with is that you're treating all properties the same, when they're clearly not. Some are in dense neighborhoods, which can cause problems, as we've heard tonight. Some are on very large lots with no neighbors. Ours is a small lot, but we really don't have any neighbors except us. Limiting number of guests to 2 per bedroom is a good idea, there are exceptions that make sense, particularly if those are 1 or 2 extra people or children. And what if you have a property that has 6 bedrooms? Is it fair to the owner to limit them to just 10 guests? I live next door to my rental property, so I don't want any events or large parties or weddings to take place. However, someone who has a large party property with distant neighbors should be able to have that option. In conclusion, I don't think Cape Elizabeth needs an ordinance such as you propose. Most of the property owners that I know in town have been renting their properties out for many years without any problems. They are aware of safety rules, and they do everything they can to minimize impact on the neighbors. And I do understand that in some neighborhoods that's not the case, as we've heard tonight. There are already ordinances in place that address noise and disorderly conduct, and I think that if my neighbors were that noisy, I would definitely call the police. Those laws need to be enforced. And if parking on the street is an issue, such as in Lawson Road, where it's a small neighborhood, then the town needs to put up no parking signs on the street. And the issues that started this whole process can't really be resolved necessarily by legislation, but they can be solved by being considerate of your neighbors and communicating with them. The rental property owners I know, including myself, want to be a good neighbor and want their guests to be safe and their properties to be safe. And I want to thank you for your work on this. This is not an easy process or an easy project. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next person, please.
Good evening. My name is Hans Croft, and I live on 10 Lawson Road. I just kind of came here. I've been living on Lawson Road for my whole life, whole 13 years. And as I've grown up, I've just been amazed at how the increase of unfamiliar faces going down our road has kind of gone up. And I just, growing up on Lawson, I've always been like, with a dog and with my family, we'd always kind of bike in the middle of the road, and there's speed limit signs, 25 miles an hour, which anybody who's lived on our street long enough kind of knows that we go a little bit slower, I guess, and because if you've lived on a street, you know that there's dogs and kids and there's young children running around, and I was amazed that one of you pointed out that there's 47 rental homes in Cape Elizabeth, and 5 of them, or 4 or 5, are on Lawson Road, and that was pretty amazing to me, and I don't know how many roads there are, but I just wanted to come out here and thank you guys for your consideration. Just know that we appreciate the time that you give here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Anyone else tonight?
Good evening. I'm Tom Dunham. I live at 11 Becky's Cove, as you know, and we have a cottage at 12 Becky's Cove Lane on 12,900 square feet, a very small lot. The whole property is grandfathered. It was built in 1898, and it has withstood the test of time. It is uninsulated. Sandy and I, over the recent years, have been up bringing it up to livable standard, habitable standards by replacing the roof 2 years ago. This past year, we the water was penetrating when we had northeast storms pounding in from the east, and so we redid the front of the cottage, the windows, and tried to make it weathertight. And then this year we're doing the we have a bathroom that's obsolete. We're investing in that to improve it for ourselves and our family. So my point is that many people think that we're profiting by renting our properties short term. In this case, we obviously would rather not rent our vacant cottage. However, it's important as a family asset. Left vacant, it would deteriorate further. Oceanfront properties require significant annual repairs and maintenance due to the harsh northeasterlies that I just stated. So we have annually invested significant monies to maintain the property. In addition to that, we have annual taxes, heat, etc. Our goal is to keep it for future family use. Each year, it is a manageable loss, mitigated by seasonal rental income. The second point I'd like to make are the discussions on fire safety issues by the planning board. It would be foolhardy for an owner not to install suggested devices that you folks have discussed. Frankly, every home in Cape Elizabeth should install the items suggested. To not have smoke detectors or other safety devices is to invite a significant financial and personal liability if an event occurred. It is common sense, and I hope that everyone on the board has such devices in their own homes. I might add, as my wife said, because there was discussions on fire ladders, we've had one in our cottage since when we bought it in 1979. I commend Joseph for providing the summary and plans for smoke detectors. I thought it was very informative. I followed up. I had a meeting with the general manager of Simplex Grinnell this week, the largest fire safety company in Maine, and probably nationwide. I also spoke to Cunningham Security. I wanted to assess if the battery-generated units that we have are sufficient, and if not, I would convert to a hardwire or wireless system that was suggested. Based on my discussions with both prominent companies, the battery devices are certainly adequate, providing the batteries are replaced every year or replaced when the devices trip. In our case, we are frequently in the cottage and would hear the units and, believe it or not, responsible enough to replace the batteries. The same would hopefully apply to all homeowners. When we started this process, everybody, the community, it was my suggestion that we have that the town consider an overlay district for the neighborhoods that are really at issue, which is Lawson Road particularly. And the area, Scarborough has done something very similar for Haggis Parkway. And so it's a nuisance issue, and it is in this intensely developed neighborhoods with small lots. But unfortunately, your guidelines or the criteria is a small lot, it impacts us. And no one's around for 500 feet. So I think my suggestion is to go back and create an overlay district with restrictions in the most built-up areas. I think that's the most effective way to do it. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone who has not yet spoken who would like to speak?
Hi, I'm June Island, 117 Old Ocean House Road. I agree with a lot of the guidelines here and the safety. It's already in place in my house. I have fire extinguishers, smoke detectors. I am concerned about the safety of the people I check in. They laugh at me when I show them where the smoke detectors are, where their fire extinguishers are, and they know where the water main is, they know where the gas shutoff is, and the electrical shutoff. They seem to think that this is extra information. I seem to think that it's important information. I've stood here and listened to a lot of horrifying stories. I can understand people's concern when there is a bachelor party going on. I don't rent my place to those type of people. I do my best to screen and ask questions. I had someone send me an inquiry just the other day. Said it was two people. They lived in South Portland, just her and her fiance. And I'm like, well, if you're living in South Portland, why do you want to rent my place in Cape Elizabeth? Oh, well, we're getting married and we want a place for some of our family to stay and we want to have a family dinner there. Can we come see it? And I'm like, well, wait a minute. How many people are you planning on putting here? Now they inquired about two people and now it's family staying. So it's, there is, you know, this back and forth that I, as a homeowner, and I maintain it myself, I'm concerned. I don't want a party there. I don't want it abused. I don't want excess people there. And I think that you need to consider us that are homeowners and are managing our properties in that manner when you do this ordinance, because it appears that, you know, the people that are subletting to sublet, well, they obviously don't have a vested interest in the party, the house, how it is maintained, or the neighborhood, or anything. They just want their income on their income. I want my house to be standing when they leave. And I want people to have a good time while they're there, and I don't want it abused. The only other issue I had is the limit of 10 people as guests. I mean, I have no intention of renting my house to 10 people. 6 people is where I limit it. But 10 people for guests, I've had people that are from the area and they wanted to have a family barbecue. I wouldn't be able to have my family over, just my husband's siblings and their children, if that was a limitation. And my yard is certainly big enough to accommodate that. But if they were having a bachelor party, I wouldn't encourage that. But if you want to have a birthday party for grandma in the afternoon, I mean, that, you know, we judge these things. But there seems to be a disparity of who the landlords are. Thank you.
Where is your rental?
117 Old Ocean House Road.
Oh, and that's the rental, not where you live?
That is not, no, I do not live there. I live in New Hampshire, unfortunately.
Thank you. Anyone else here who has not spoken tonight that wishes to speak? In that case, the public hearing is now closed, and it is to the board. I would suggest that we go through the ordinance sequentially, start at the beginning. I think we're all sufficiently familiar with it. It's logically may seem a little out of sequence, but I think that's the best way to do it. So why don't we start on page 1. There are 3 definitions that have been added there: short-term rental, short-term rental guest, and tenant. So does anyone have any comments or suggested changes to anything on page 1? Okay, let's move the next ordinance changes, I believe we will find on page 3, adding short-term rental as a, under the non-residential use category. Okay. Same thing on page 4, when we're now in the Residence B district. Oh, actually, there are two on page 4. But just cross-references, really. Page 5, same thing. Page 6, the same thing, cross-reference, non-residential use. Page 7. Page 8. Page 9. Page 10. Page 11 is the first time we come up with anything substantive. Let's start by taking a look at the parking space requirements. The ordinance, as now drafted, requires one space per 4 tenants with a minimum of 2 spaces, does not include any requirement, any separate requirement for spaces that would relate to guests as opposed to tenants. Does anyone want to make any suggestions for this provision? Peter?
Just a clarification. There was quite a bit of mention of the impact of parking on the neighborhood quality of life. And I believe we said at one of our prior meetings or workshops that parking, there's nothing to prohibit parking on the lawns, correct?
That is correct.
In Cape Elizabeth?
That is correct. In fact, we're somewhat limited in that we have actually allowed overflow parking on parts of the Inn by the Sea as part of their site plan approval.
But in a residential neighborhood, the solution of getting all these excess cars up on the front lawn as opposed to a street and driveway?
There's nothing that prohibits under existing or what's proposed, there's nothing that prohibits parking a car on the lawn. There's nothing that prohibits you from parking your car on the street unless it's the winter or you have parked your car on the street in such a manner that you have not left a minimum gap of 10 feet for emergency vehicles to pass through, or you're in one of the very few neighborhoods in town where explicitly does prohibits on-street parking.
Yeah, I must say I have some sympathy with the notion that somebody who lives in the property may have parties occasionally, the cars may spread out on the street, but where something is rented repetitively in a festive situation, which most short-term rentals are, that you're going to have a lot of excess cars around and somehow stuffing them onto the front yard does sound like a negative that I think people have a right to be concerned about. I'm not quite sure what we do about it, but it's I think I'm focusing on that more than I had previously.
When you look at parking, it's usually easier to look at the activity that's generating the need for the parking and regulating that, mm-hmm. rather than trying to find a space for the cars.
No, I agree.
So, I think if you look at the parking, you want to look more at the intensity of use provisions than the problem is you can say that all the, and your ordinance right now says that all the parking for the tenants has to be provided on the lot, not in the street. So even if you were to increase the amount of parking that's required, let's say you went from one space per 4 tenants to one space per 2 tenants, and property did not have enough space in the parking in the driveway to accommodate those cars, what they could end up doing is paving a part of their front yard. And I don't think anybody would be happy with that solution either. So,
correct.
So this is the problem. You can either find a way to get the cars off the road, and you may not be happy with the result, or you look at the root generator of the parking.
So I want to say something. I mean, this has been a long process, and I know Maureen and Elaine, you might not appreciate this at all, but Maureen just put, made a really good point. You can regulate the use or you can regulate the side effects. And I feel like this process has been really frustrating and that we can't regulate the side effects. We talk about, we want to regulate the parking, I feel like there's a roadblock. We want to regulate the noise, there's a roadblock. Because it happens on nights and weekends when the code enforcement officer isn't around and the police officer's hands are tied. And I guess where I'm throughout this process, I just feel increasingly, despite my initial thought that we needed to compromise with where the town council was going with this and where they told us that they needed us to be or else they would ignore what we said, is I don't think there should be short-term rentals in this town and in small neighborhoods. And I just feel really strongly about that. And when I go back to the comprehensive plan and what people value in this town, I see that this is going to be increasing trend. Somebody brought up the point about interest rates. That is absolutely true. Only the wealthy, only investors right now have access to low interest rates. And 90% of mortgages in the last year went to high credit individuals. That used to be 50%. Well, those high credit individuals, they already own houses. They're buying second homes now. And they're turning them into rentals. The internet is changing things. I just feel like unless we prohibit it, it's going to keep growing. And it's very hard to regulate the side effects. And so I guess I know as part of the political process, perhaps we need to give the town council something that they told us only they would consider. But in my heart of hearts, as a member of this community, I don't feel it's the right thing, and I also think we need to give investors regulatory certainty. People need to know what is the landscape. Can they invest in this manner or not? And so whatever we do, it shouldn't be something that we just start at the edges and then we might change it in a few years if it doesn't work. I actually feel like as a person who's concerned about our economy, we need to provide more regulatory certainty for people that are buying homes in this town. And so we shouldn't think of this as an incremental process.
I think this is, you present a really good example of, I think, what we may see more of tonight. We've all discussed this issue a lot. I know you have that point of view. There are others on our group here that have a different point of view. So as these issues come up, what I would propose is that we take an informal consensus and see if there are a majority of people in the group who are inclined to go that direction. And if so, we can discuss the specifics of how we will do it. At this stage, I think if there's not a majority, we should move ahead. I think there are going to be a number of issues where we may have some real variation of opinion. I think that's why this is such a hard ordinance for us, why it's been so hard for the Ordinance Committee, and it's going to be difficult for the Town Council. So let's see if there is anyone else on the group who's inclined to consider an outright prohibition on short-term rentals in all or any part of Cape Elizabeth. Does anyone else want to pursue this idea?
As you know, all along I have said that. But
can you be a little closer? I'm having trouble hearing you.
All along I have said that, and I've agreed with that. That's been my position. I've written something up that shows more of the reality is we need to present something to the council that will be more of a compromise, or it will be just discarded along with some of the very good things that we've done. So I would say I don't like the short-term rentals either, Liza, but we probably should continue the process.
So you're saying you're personally for banning them in some or all of Cape Elizabeth, but given the political, what you think the political realities are with the town council, you're not inclined to advocate that position?
Correct, and I have more to say on that, but if we're going to continue the process of going page by page by page, I can save it for later.
Okay.
Whatever you recommend.
Anyone else of a mind to ban it entirely? Because if so, I think we need to, that changes everything.
Entirely or partially?
It ban short-term rentals in any part of Cape Elizabeth.
Peter's got to pull his mic up. Peter, your mic.
Peter?
I think short would be less than 30 days.
Mike.
Trying to get her to identify what banning, right now, we've banned less than 3 days.
Right.
You would extend this to less than 30 days.
So you would prohibit any rental less than 30 days?
Yeah, and maybe in smaller lots. But I just think it's very damaging to our neighborhoods, and it's what I value most about our town.
Okay, anyone else? Anyone want to consider a complete prohibition in any portion of the town? Okay, I don't think I would encourage whoever feels that way to pass your views on to the council. Obviously, it goes beyond this, but I don't think it's productive for us to spend more time on that tonight. Peter.
Something else that maybe we might find consensus on, I think I was probably one of the first movers on getting rid of the 30,000, pardon me, foot exemption. From all I've heard from the public input, people seem to think that was not needed, so I would certainly back off and say we could consider restoring the 30,000 square foot exclusion.
Anybody else? Victoria.
I'd have to go back and look at the original document that was presented to us from the Ordinance Committee, but when they presented it to us, there were certain restrictions on the 30,000 that were not on larger lots, and one of them was safety, one of them was septic, and there were certain items that I felt, and that's why I agreed with you to get rid of the minimum, that it should be a more even playing field, because certain items were not included. But not to say that the council possibly could reconsider a lot restriction as far as maybe tenants and numbers of guests.
Good point. I think I was not addressing the life safety issues, but on the larger lots where the noise and renter conduct either is or isn't a problem, that perhaps the 30,000 square foot thing did make some sense.
Makes sense in terms of outline in less than 30,000 square foot lots, or just regulating more heavily?
Not regulating some of the intensity of use requirements that we've had.
Okay.
We would have to maybe go back to a workshop and look at what we pull out and what is very important to keep in, if you want to go back to a workshop, or it will go to the council, and I hope they review this meeting and listen to some of that input, and I'm sure that they are going to make changes to what we present to them.
Anyone else, Henry?
The 30,000 is just a line in the sand. If there's no problem with noise on greater than 30,000, there's no problem. I mean, if it's a problem with a lesser size than 30,000, there's a problem. So the limiting it to a particular size doesn't limit the problem or do away with the problem on the smaller areas or in the larger areas. You could get 200 people turn up in a big area and let off fireworks and drive the neighbors crazy even if they're half a mile away. So I think it's wrong to make a distinction between 30,000 and greater. If people are going to be good neighbors, then they should be good neighbors regardless of the size of their property.
Conceptually, I agree with you totally. It just seemed to me, though, there seems to be very little traction in the public view of that 30,000 foot.
Well, I agree there's no traction there. But on the other hand, you, as my colleague said over here, you can't just suddenly say, well, I'm going to impose safety issues on this size and not safety issues on that size. I mean, it should be a level playing field. And that means no noise and no disturbances and all the rest of it. And if that's the case, then I think one of the people that stood up today said something that we've missed, and it comes out on page 13 at area 5, so I'll wait until we get to there before I do it. But I think they made a very good suggestion.
I got a question.
Yes.
We've heard nuisance. Does that fall under zoning or something else?
Thank you for asking that question.
Yeah.
Mr. Clifford, I think, made some really good suggestions, but I would like to strongly remind the Planning Board that the nuisance ordinance is not within your purview. And when in the past you made recommendations for changes to the nuisance ordinance, it didn't happen. So I would suggest that you focus on what you do have authority to do, which is the zoning ordinance. And if you have recommendations for the town council to take another look at the nuisance ordinance, you can include that in a recommendation. But to make the effort to try to rewrite the nuisance ordinance now when you have no authority and no referral from the council, I strongly question the efficiency of your time in that endeavor.
However, don't we often, as part of our ordinances, and I know we did heavily in the BA zone, regulate things like hours when parties can occur outside or when music can be played outside, the sort of closing hour thing. So would that be something we could do that say that after 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock, and we could go back and forth a lot about that one too, that no outside music can be played. I mean, that's something we have done in a commercial
but
context.
You were doing it in a commercial context,
right.
And that's the limit, because you were using your authority under site plan review to impose some of those regulations.
But is there any reason why that could not be included in a zoning ordinance?
If you include that in the zoning ordinance, it could apply to everyone. It could apply to the graduation parties and the
But family. We could apply it just to short-term rentals, could we not?
You could try. I have some concerns. You're going to be going in down a road you're not going to be happy with.
Does the same thing not apply to fireworks? I mean, I thought fireworks were illegal anyway without special permission.
Exactly, which is why, again, yeah. So, but and the real challenge is what we've been hearing all along, that there are neighbors that are putting up with a lot of activities and that they're putting up with those activities over and over and over again, which I think makes it legitimate for the town and the planning board to look at the appropriateness of the use itself. But the activities are coming under other ordinances. And, you know, the whole idea that we need to enforce these ordinances, well, it's really difficult for the police to enforce things where they're not getting the phone calls. And I just want to make it clear, because I've been involved in this process before the planning board took it over from the council. But we asked the police chief to come to the ordinance committee meetings. We asked him to provide records of complaints, and there are no records. So it's been made clear neighbors are very uncomfortable making phone calls. Even tonight, we've heard awful situation, lots of people were unhappy, one neighbor made a phone call. So I think the fact that there's a large group of people are unhappy suggests that there's a problem with the use. But the fact is that there are still options for handling the behavior. And frankly, if the nuisance ordinance is not up to the task, it's not the job of the planning board to beef it up. It's the job of the town council, because you have explicitly conveyed to you authority over the zoning ordinance and the subdivision ordinance. So again, you can send you could send something forward and say, and by the way, you know, we respectfully recommend that you need to take a hard look at the nuisance ordinance.
And I just want to say, if we could regulate the side effects effectively, I think that would be the way to go. It just doesn't seem like that is feasible.
Carol Ann?
No, I'm starting to forget what I wanted to say here. A lot of the activity that people, that it's causing the most trouble, there already are laws on the books to cover them. Public nudity, public drunkenness, they're not just Cape Elizabeth laws, they're state laws. And we are planning board, we're not the legislature, we can't do anything about that particular thing. That's up to the police, and if the maybe the police should be patrolling Lawson Road on a regular basis and not waiting for a phone call. But that's not for me to say. That's not for me to tell the police chief, you've got to do that. It's up to the neighborhood to get in there and really make things happen by being such a pain in the butt that he's not gonna let it slide. And I hate saying that, but that's what happens. That's why how things happen. And we've got to focus on what we can regulate, which is zoning ordinance. And I'm sorry, but I don't think we can regulate much to do with public drunkenness, nudity, people having sex outside of somebody's house. And I'm appalled by all these things. I would be very upset living in the neighborhood that
that that was happening in. But I would also be so upset that I would be in Nikki Williams' office on a regular basis wanting to know why they're not taking care of it. So, and so we spend a lot of time discussing things that we don't have any control over, and we don't, other than as private citizens, and we can go before the council and we can present our feelings about this as well as everybody else after having listened to all of this. But at some point, we've got to send something back to the town council. The thing I heard tonight that bothered me the most, and I don't remember hearing it before, and I may have forgotten, is a subletter who is renting out property. And I don't know if there's anything that we can do about that as a planning board. And I don't know where something like that could be dealt with, but that is appalling.
Well, we started talking about whether we could require that any property that was done with a short-term rental be permitted only by someone who was residing in the property, some kind of a residence requirement or ownership requirement, and came to the conclusion that that was not a feasible thing to do. And Maureen, you might be able to remind us of why we came to that conclusion. But
I believe it was a political consideration rather than a legal consideration. There are some of these short-term rentals are held by families, and none of the family members live in Cape Elizabeth. They come back to visit. I think the house that is mentioned the most frequently is the Armstrong household. The Dunhams, sitting right here, are renting out one that they live next door to. Jim Huebner is renting out one that he lives. So there's no way he could live in both homes. So you have those situations. Could you put in a requirement that it has to be owner-occupied? We do that for accessory dwelling units. I guess you could try it. I'm skeptical that it would survive a political review.
Could we put in something that it has to be owner, the owner must be the person doing the rental? I mean, I don't know if we could do that.
Again, I mean, I don't, if the party that did the renting 2 weeks ago was a nice, quiet couple, nobody would be upset. I mean, it's really the use that is generating the most angst.
So that brings us back to regulating events, which we talked about before and is not in here. And
it is under your intensity, your rental intensity. You've addressed it that way. You have addressed it in a much lesser extent under your subsurface disposal because you're looking at capacity of a house to handle traffic. And you have required that parking has to be on the property. So those three things tend to somewhat encompass the event issue.
And there are other ways to regulate intensity. It's not just number of people or the length of stay. It could be the number of rental events per year. You can only rent it out, you know, to three different parties per year.
Although you could attempt something like that, but the more of those things you attempt, I have to tell you, I really am becoming skeptical there's going to be any chance you'll be able to enforce it. Oh, that wasn't a party. That was just my family getting together. And how do you make the distinction? Whereas number of people, it's number of people no matter what they're doing.
Henry?
Well, under Section 5, again, on 13, you say rental agreement addendum. Short-term rental permit application.
We're not there yet.
Well, yes, but I mean, it leads to a point about subletting.
Okay.
The point is, you can build in the fact that you cannot sublet under that terminology. In other words, the rental agreement should not be a subletter's signature signing that to a lease. Like my tenants in my buildings can't sublet, and it's a specific statement in the lease to that person. You are not allowed to sublet without my specific permission or my company's specific permission.
I see what you're saying.
So, you know, and there's one other thing while we're at it that I think should go in there, and it's something else that would tend to police it a lot better. The gentleman here said he took a deposit and then didn't return the deposit when they breached the agreement of their agreement. And, of course, it was only $500, but I inquired how much. But if it was a significant amount, and it was, because money talks, and it was, if you do this, 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 or this, you will lose your deposit, Either people won't rent under those conditions, or they will, and they're pretty well guaranteed that they'll be able to get their deposit back because they'll behave.
Yeah.
And that would limit some of the problems that you get, like no nudity, et cetera, no swimming after hours, and so forth. And that's an agreement between the renter and the tenant. I pick nudity because we've gone on a couple of times about that. So that would be my recommendation for leasing it.
We impose a minimum security deposit?
Well, I don't know how you do that, but I think that you have to impose them. You have to have them put a significant deposit on there. Maybe it's given to the town as a nuisance value that says the town holds $2,000 a security deposit on this building, not generating too much profits. And if it does, then you forfeit the deposit, or it's more appropriate for the tenant.
Peter?
I think that getting the zoning ordinance into the economic arrangements between landlord and tenant is really a mistake. And Maureen's quite right. Our Cape Elizabeth's nuisance ordinance is really kind of fluffy. I mean, I think it could be fixed up in a lot of ways. And I'm sure that there are situations where it could and should be applied that don't have anything to do with short-term rentals at all. But to me, it is a zoning ordinance. We are talking about use and not behavior. Much as I sympathize with the tenant situations that they found, I don't think you can have a zoning ordinance getting into details of drunkenness, nudity, and whatnot. It just doesn't work that way. So I almost come back to Lisa's thing. Maybe you, if the kind of rentals are attracting the problem renters, if it's the weekend or the 3-day or the 4-day or 5-day, maybe you prohibit 7 days or less. I don't know. I think 30 is not a great idea, but the really short-term rentals, and then regulate intensity of use in some fashion, be it by parking or number of people in the building, and that's the price you pay for renting it repetitively.
Somebody saying this is a 7-day or a 5-day or whatever it is, and using it for 2 days and going away, instead of charging $3,000 for the week or for the day, they charge $3,000 for a period of time, or maybe more. And so you can't really tell the intensity. All you can say is that you're not getting that number of people turning up. But it won't limit things like bachelor parties.
It'll dissuade them. If most people would not rent, take a 7-day rental for a 3-day event. I mean, some would, sure. You can't be bulletproof.
Well, they're not actually taking it. They're only taking it for 3 days, but you've just knocked the other 4 days off the calendar and you've met the requirement. I mean, I'm not trying to say how to do it, but I'm saying that you can't legislate or you can't put in words that stop that happening just by saying you can't have it for less than a certain period of time. It's just a matter of words is how you call that time. You get 4 days free. If you buy three, you get another 4 days free.
But excuse me, but if I'm one of these houses that offers daily rentals for $750 or whatever some of them are, and I'm not allowed to. Based on that, I'm gonna cut
well, that's
my
true.
Amount.
You are right there.
I'm gonna say I'll let this person have it for 3 days, and I can't rent it for the other four, so I'm losing money on this week.
Well, yeah, so, I agree with you on that. That's
so ridiculous. So they can't even advertise it as being available on a daily basis because it's not available on a daily basis. It's only available on a weekly basis. I mean, potentially.
So you're suggesting that we should make it weekly rather a minimum of 7 days rather than a minimum of three?
I'm becoming inclined to go that way, yes.
And I've always felt that way.
Okay, so wait.
Regulating the intensity of use.
How many people would change the minimum rental from 3 days to seven? Do we have a consensus on that one? Okay. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Turn to page 12.
Okay. I might be inclined to do that, but only if we also go back to dealing with the issue of proximity, because I really think that we're brushing with much too broad a brush here. And I'm more persuaded by those people who said, let's put in some kind of a limit, some kind of a measure of proximity, whether 30,000 square feet is the right one or not, I'm not sure, and then perhaps regulate more intensely. And I'm also inclined, as I listen to what people are saying about how different it is if you have an owner, someone who's there renting, and how different it is to go back to consider what I initially thought was a crazy idea and was all in favor of taking out, and that is if the owner of the property either resides at or within a certain proximity of the property. And if we went back to that and put that in, not for the safety issues can apply to everybody, and it's a pain to have to register with the town, but I think that could, but if we go back and do some kind of a size regulation on the issues that relate to intensity of use, then I would be more inclined to require the longer terms. But since there are many people who are already voting for that, probably don't need my vote.
I would go with that, Elaine.
I would go with that if you can tell me exactly what does not apply to everyone and what applies to just some people.
And I actually think we can do that tonight. I don't think that would need to take it back.
So let's go to workshop. Page by page?
Yeah. Yes, we
with
can,
that
although
in mind?
This issue comes up with one space per four tenants. I actually think we heard an awful lot about parking, and even if you can park on the lawn, my guess is if on those smaller lots we required one space for every two tenants, that their yards would soon become too small to have 20 cars parked out there.
I also think they should be required to find to provide parking spaces for guests.
Yes, I would agree with that too.
And that will effectively limit small lots. That would effectively limit small lots as well.
Right. Because a lot of what we were hearing were on very small lots, a bachelor party, where every tenant came in a separate car. And that's the kind of use that we were hearing was particularly problematic. So I think I would start with the parking.
What is the recommendation?
One space for... And I actually think this could apply to any size lot, because as you get to bigger lots, you're going to have more space. One space per every two tenants with a minimum of two spaces. And then, I don't know, how would we deal, maybe...
It's the guests that are the problem, not the tenants.
Actually, it's both. With that fraternity party, I think those were tenants. I think it's both.
There again, how do you know they are?
I suppose we could do one space per every two tenants or... tenants or guests, so that if you were going to have if you were going to have a party with 20 people on the lot, if we were even to leave it that high, you would have to have 10 parking spaces on the property.
So well, the house has a capacity that's stated in the permit, so you don't have to just have the 10 spaces for having a party. The house has to carry with it the 10 spaces.
Well, you get four people to a car, but if you buy a truck or something like that, you can get six to eight or a minivan. So you've got, you're back again to this thing. I got two spaces, I can get six people in my car. I want 12 people, I want 12 guests.
Well, I think this is not the only place we have to do it. And this is, legislation is all about drawing lines.
I understand.
And lines are by definition imperfect. But I think we have to draw some. And everything we do, people can get around. I think we need to come as close as we can to drawing lines that relate to the activity we're trying to regulate. And I think parking relates to some of the problems we've been seeing. And yeah, somebody can come with a van. We've already prohibited buses, don't we?
Yes.
From somewhere else. But somebody can come with something that's a minivan and therefore not a bus and crowd a lot of people in it. I think we can't draw every line as fine as we can, but I think this is a way to draw a rational one.
Well, we defined it as a car rather than the minivan, right?
It's a vehicle.
It's a vehicle. So I would say one space per two persons on the property during the term of the short-term rental. I thought that there may be a more elegant way to do it.
Can we say tenants and guests, since those are defined terms?
One space per each of tenants and guests, or whatever, yes.
Can't we say four, because you get four in a car?
No. I think what we were hearing tonight is that each one of those bachelors was coming in their own vehicle.
Right, there are four of them. Well, you're saying two came in one car.
And if you have a family that has two kids, well, you know, so probably you have two parking spaces and you can probably take care of it.
The point being that in order for those eight people to show up, they would have to provide a minimum of four spaces, and then they would have to provide four more spaces for the extra cars that showed up, which would take up all of their party space on the front lawn, potentially. I mean, it's like, it's exactly what Elaine says. I mean, we can parse this thing a thousand different ways, but let's just pick one and move it forward so we can get further discussion going.
So, four votes.
Do we have four votes for one space per two tenants or guests?
I just want to ask a question. Are we saying, though, that the number of spaces goes with is a function of the house itself?
Well, the number of guests permitted is a function of two things. There's an overall max, but there's also a maximum that's created by the septic requirements and the bedroom requirements. Right.
No, there's additional parking information on page 13, which means they have to define their parking plan, and if they have off-site parking, that they need to define where it is, and they have to show an appropriate agreement.
It sounds like we're requiring on-site parking for everybody.
No, what you're requiring is that if you have a short-term rental with four bedrooms, then you need four parking spaces, and plus if you want to be able to have 10 guests, you would need another five parking spaces, which would be nine parking spaces. So you would then have to come up with a plan that shows that you can accommodate nine spaces. Now, you could accommodate all of them on site, or you could say, I'm going to accommodate six of them on site, and then my next door neighbor is going to give me permission for an extra two or three, and here's the letter from my next door neighbor saying that they agree to let me park an extra two or three cars over there.
So I just want to point out to the board and the public that this is a really great example of how difficult it is to regulate the side effects, because this short-term landlord could secure eight parking spaces off-site, but there is no guarantee that the short-term tenants would use them, nor is there any obligation for the tenants to use them. So here is our circular world of trying to regulate the side effects versus the underlying use.
But to be fair, if you had provided a plan that showed that you were going to provide most of your parking off-site, and then you actually have people parking all over the place on your property, in theory, you could call the code officer. In theory, the code officer should be able to pull the permit and say, well, you didn't show that you were going to put five cars in the front yard. You showed you were only going to put three cars in the front yard, and the rest of them are going to be someplace else. So in theory, you're in violation of your short-term rental permit.
But as part of their application, they could be in the front yard, and they can also park on the street.
But if this is why this isn't necessarily, I mean, this isn't necessarily going to solve the problem.
Yeah. So I just want to just reiterate why this is exemplary of our broader problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so purpose statement. I think we're down to the bottom of page 11.
On page 11, on line 29, I've written one space per two tenants plus one space per two guests with a minimum of two spaces.
Right.
And that's by consensus. That's what your new draft says.
Okay. Purpose. Anyone, we need to change the purpose.
Where are we at?
Page 12.
Now we're on page 12 with applicability, and if we're going to reinsert some kind of a 30,000 square foot provision, that's what I'm about to say. I don't think this is where we do it. I think we do it later on when we get to...
Do it someplace on page 13.
Yeah, someplace on page 13. So the ordinance, everyone who, if you live anywhere in Cape Elizabeth and you rent your house for more than 14 days on a short-term basis, you'll have the registration requirement. You'll have to sign up with the town in some way. That's essentially what the applicability section says.
It also has the definition that you, a minimum term
3 days.
Is 3 days.
So the issue comes here, whether we want the minimum term to be 3 days for everybody, whether we want it to be 3 days depending on lot size, or whether we want to raise it up to 7. This is the place to talk about that.
I'm for raising it up to 7 for everyone.
Okay. How many people are up?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
I am for changing that to 7 days for everyone.
Regardless of lot size, proximity.
That's what I'm throwing out.
Okay. Anybody else of that view? 7 days for everybody.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Looks like we've got a majority on that. So let's go with it.
So to clarify, on page 12, line 7, it will read, a short-term rental of less than 7 days is not permitted.
Okay. All right. Review procedure. Anything else on this page? Short-term rental form, the inspection, submission requirements, anything else on this page? Permit valid for 1 year, all of that stays. Okay. Page 13, limit on, well, let's see, top of page 13, I'm sorry, there's page 13. Standards. Anything on 13? I had a suggestion on page, on item 2, building evacuation plan. It wasn't clear to me that the building evacuation plan needed to be submitted to the code enforcement officer as well as being prominently posted. Perhaps it's implied that it needs to be included as part of the application, but I would want to clarify that. Is it?
If you
well, it has to be in the rental agreement.
In the rental agreement addendum, which has to be submitted so you can prove that you have it, on page 14, line 1, it says you have to show that you have a building evacuation plan.
Okay, great. Sanitary waste disposal puts a limit on the number of tenants as well as anything else we might do to limit tenants.
And it does say that the limit is 2 tenants for every 1 bedroom. And
yes.
It doesn't give you any exemption if some of the occupants of the bedroom are children.
Correct. Okay. Next page, limit on rental intensity. This is where we have the maximum 10 tenants and 10 guests at any one time.
Should we talk about deposits back on section 5 on page 13?
Rental
agreement addendum. I mean, I'm for insisting on a deposit of a reasonable amount, but it may not meet a consensus.
Does anyone else want to include a requirement regarding a rental deposit?
Sorry.
Okay.
Okay.
Can we go back to something else that Henry suggested earlier, and that has to do with do we have any authority in here legally to enter something on about a subletting, or is that part of a rental agreement thing? Is that just
It's an ownership thing, and that you should be staying on it.
Okay.
Anyone want to try to craft anything? We should try to craft something on subletting.
I can't
can prohibit subletting in the applicability section.
We could prohibit subletting, yes. And there are ways, I think, to deal with it. Anybody want to try to? We could, for example, say that the owner, or, for example, if a property is owned by a family trust, we could say that the owner or a person who is a beneficiary or otherwise related to the owner. It's kind of, we'd have to think about a little bit about how we did it, but we could come to that effect, which would cover properties that are owned in family trusts or family LLCs or that sort of thing. We could allow that, or an individual who's a member of the LLC, to be a tenant without allowing an owner to lease to an unrelated entity, and that unrelated entity.
Could we just say the lessor must be the owner?
We can draft it, and we ever enforce it is another question.
Wait, could we just say the lessor must be the owner?
We could.
I'm having a hard time seeing the basis for that. I mean, Henry prohibits subletting because it's in his own self-interest to do so. But most of these people, it's in their interest to sublet from a financial standpoint. And I don't know.
Well, the owner of the building signs a lease agreement with the tenant, right? Now, that doesn't matter for how long that tenant's in there. And if that agreement says you can't sublet, then that's the limit of where it goes. Now, would the primary owner have some reason to allow subletting from a tenant?
Sure. It may make them easier to find a tenant, but there's nothing inherently wrong with subletting.
Maybe. But remember that now you go to the second level. The second level, you don't have any vet capability. You're not vetting them. You don't know who they're going to be. It just could be anybody. The guy says, give me $1,500 for the day, and you give that, and he could end up with somebody who's, God forbid, a mass murderer on the site. I mean, you've not got the responsibility. If you, as the owner or the initial person, you are vetting that tenant.
Can the permit only be issued to the owner of the property?
Well, I cover it by saying no subletting, so
yeah.
Please yourselves.
Always seems clear when it's in a lease that I've signed, no subletting.
Sorry?
Always has seemed very clear in any lease that I've signed as a tenant, no subletting.
Yeah.
Right. But I don't know why it needs to be more complicated.
I don't know if you can, as you say, whether we can legally impose that.
Whether we have any legal standing to do that, I don't know.
And you may be prohibiting a lot of situations that are perfectly benign and proper. I don't see the ability to sublet as the cause of the problem.
Well, it would be to the owner of the property's advantage to put that in, because otherwise what happens is, as was said by the public today, that the sublet tenants, the second level tenants, seem to be a problem. There's nothing to worry. They come down, they have a party, and that's the problem.
But to be honest, Henry, I mean, most of the complaints we've heard are from tenants who weren't subletted. They were tenants that were rented to by the owner.
But at least you're trying to cut out one level somewhere along the line.
It just comes back, I think, to regulating the underlying use.
Yeah,
I agree. That's easier to do than regulating the unattractive or negative side effects.
It would be very simple. What's if you clean? Could say no undesirable characters are omitted.
Yeah, right.
Well, getting back into the real world of things we can do, how many people would like to include some kind of a subletting restriction in the statute? One, two. Is that it? Okay, then I think we can move on past that one. Limit on rental intensity. No more than two tenants per bedroom. Shall not include non-bedroom sleeping areas. I'm not sure what that to me is a little...
You can't set up a futon in the living room and call it a bedroom.
Family room, the den.
You have
so what you mean is
bedrooms.
Bedroom shall not include. The term bedroom shall not include.
Right.
Okay. To me, that's a little a little unclear there.
Yeah, but we're going to live with it. you've been talking about reinstituting the 30,000 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
Probably right above number six might be a place to do that. If you did it there, what you would be doing is saying that this rental intensity provision only applies to the smaller lots.
I would think that it wouldn't be the no more than two tenants per bedroom, but it would be the not to exceed, and perhaps the number of guests. Because the two tenants per bedroom seems to me to relate to...
But you've already got that under subsurface disposal.
So why are we repeating it here, then?
Because this is where you were really trying to get... This was the event provision.
So what you're saying is we don't need to say no more than two tenants per bedroom at all. We would say lots of 30,000 square feet, a maximum of X. Lots of under 30,000 square feet, a maximum of Y.
You've expressed an interest in going back down the road of the 30,000 square feet.
Right.
And the provision that the ordinance committee had, that this provision, the rental intensity provision, is really the let's try to get our handle on the events provision. And this is where they drew the line, where they, well, actually, they drew it a lot higher, but I know you won't go there. Mm-mm. So they basically were saying, we're only going to set a limit on events for the lots that are small, and that for the lots that are larger, we're not going to look at the size of the event.
But this doesn't seem to be just related to events, because the prior provision just
yes.
relates to, isn't it just for houses on septic or non-septic?
Well, yes.
Yes, okay,
but
so.
This, the major function of this is really the event. This is the best teeth you've got in here to regulate the big events. Yes, other things nibble away at the edges, but the only purpose for having this is to try to keep groups small.
Because it's saying that a bedroom must be a bedroom. It's not the living room couch.
Right.
And you can max out at 10.
Right.
So in a smaller area, it's setting a limit on the number of people who can be there.
So I have a house with six bedrooms, but no living room, no dining room. I've got a kitchen.
You can only have 10. Sorry.
That's right.
But what we're talking about is if your lot's large enough, perhaps you could have more than
right. 10. Right. On lots of less than 30,000 square feet, you can only have 10 tenants. You can have a maximum of 10 tenants.
And the thing to consider is if you want to put, and I'm not advocating for the 30,000 because you were adamant you wanted to take it out, you all of a sudden seem to be interested in it. But if you were willing to install the 30,000 square foot line here, you might be willing to drop these numbers a little bit lower as well. So
I always was an advocate for the 30,000 square feet, but
okay.
I was in the minority. I acknowledge that.
So, and I'm not advocating for or against it, but I mean, I think the ordinance committee had some of these other provisions not apply. My sense is from the direction the planning board's been moving is that you're pretty comfortable with 1 through 5, and that 6, maybe you split it up into for lots that are only greater than 30,000, and then for lots that are below 30,000, you have a smaller number. Or you go wild and you say if you're above 30,000, we're not going to limit the rental intensity because we're going to just rely on septic systems and parking requirements to do what they need to do. And then if you have 6 only apply to those compact lots, maybe there's a willingness to tighten it up a little more.
Can I ask one other question? Is there any way to regulate proximity as opposed to lot size?
You can say that you can only have so many in a neighborhood, but then the question is, who gets in first?
No, that's not my question.
You mean a
my
linear
question
distance
is,
between houses?
If your house is located more than X number of feet from the closest adjacent mm-hmm. residence, I know, again, mm-hmm. we do that in the BA zone.
Sure.
Different applies. If the closest residence is within 100 feet.
You'd probably go property line because I would think... In the interest of fairness, you know, if your neighbor is a lot closer to their property line, to your common property line than you are, you would probably wouldn't want to penalize that person. So you would probably say, if I want to rent my short-term rental and my house is only 15 feet from the property line, then I can only do X. And if my house is 30 feet or more from the property line, then I can do X plus 4.
That would work because you get to the same thing. Although if your house is 50 feet and the other guy's house is 50 feet, you have 100-foot separation.
Right.
So.
Right.
But haven't we got this covered other than that? I mean, you've got it covered by number of bedrooms, by this. I mean, you're not going to have these small lot houses with lots and lots of bedrooms, so they're limited straight away. I mean,
Actually, you do.
You're saying these small lot have lots of bedrooms?
You have some houses that are on lots of less than 30,000 square feet that have six bedrooms.
In Lawson Road.
In Lawson Road, in People's Cove.
So they're limited to 12 people?
Yes. Well, actually, they're limited to 10 people.
Right. And so what would you propose if you reintroduced the 30,000, reducing that, or just saying that lots over that don't have any control?
In terms of the maximum number, I'm actually, based on what we've been hearing about the issues, I'm interested in thinking about the proximity issue more than the lot size issue. Well, distance from the property line. I don't know if anyone else is interested in exploring that.
Yeah, I think it's a very valid point. It is the proximity that's the problem, not the size of the lot. And you can have bad situations with a lot of back lot that isn't affected, but the houses are close together.
Victoria, did you have something to add?
Well, I've got a question. Isn't there something in the wetland laws about if there's six houses within a certain number of feet? How did you ever come up with that formula?
God, you really want to go there, huh?
That's the proximity. That's a
right,
proximity
right.
issue.
It's, well, it's not really. It was a way to measure density. And the concept was that if you're in the RP1 district, there's a 250-foot buffer around the RP1 wetlands. But there are now six different ways to get that 250-foot buffer reduced down to 100 feet. And one of the concepts was if you're in a, quote, densely developed area. And the way we define densely developed is we ask the council, identify some neighborhoods that you consider densely developed. And they picked out some neighborhoods, and we measured out the density. And it was a very crude calculation. But what we said is, if you want to build here, and the wetland is here, and you can draw a circle, you can go 250 feet out from your building site, and you draw a circle, and you hit six main buildings, then you're considered densely developed. And that's that six 250 feet, 500 foot diameter circle, roughly equated to the density of those neighborhoods that the council identified.
You don't happen to know those lot sizes, would you? What that roughly was?
No.
Because I worry about saying 30,000.
But the thing is, though, that 250 feet was a rough calculation of a character decision that the council made. They said, you know, Eastfield and Shore Acres, and, you know, these are neighborhoods that we consider as densely developed. And the interesting thing about that standard is it actually pushes the new development next to the old development and away from the wetland, because you want to grab those six buildings. So it actually works for the policy. I mean, if you wanted to come up with a density, you could just pick some neighborhoods and say, okay, I think if you're in the Lawson Road neighborhood that, you know, you shouldn't be allowed to do certain things. And we could pick Lawson Road and People's Cove and Surf Road and calculate that density and then say, okay, if you're, you know, beyond that, then you can do certain things. But we have already looked at that. If you look at the lots, that spreadsheet that you guys received seems a long time ago. You know, the 30,000 was what was capturing those compact neighborhoods. And you went above 30,000 and you started moving out of the compact neighborhoods into places where we weren't hearing complaints. And even People's Cove, now that they have recorded their subdivision plan, a lot of those lots fall under the 30,000 square foot.
About an acre.
Hmm?
How about an acre?
Do I hear 60,000 square feet?
Three dunams.
Well, a lot of those houses fall, lots fall well under 30,000.
Yep, some fall a little bit, some fall a lot. And I can pull out the spreadsheet if you want and read down through the square footages.
You know, as much as I like Elaine's measurement concept and proximity, it's a whole lot easier just to do lot size, because that's an already known number for every residential lot, so you don't have a whole lot of homework to figure out whether it's applicable or not.
Do we already have the calculation for densely developed areas? That one works, right?
You mean for the wetlands?
The wetlands one.
Could we
take that same concept? Because to me, that's kind of the same. It's a little more complicated, but I wonder if it would be a little bit...
So the idea would be if you want to have a short-term rental, you have to draw a line out so far and then a circle, and if you hit six buildings, you can't have a short-term rental?
You could have, the maximum number of people would be less. I wouldn't prohibit it anywhere, at least.
You could do that, but the lot size number is just such an easier way to get at that.
Yeah, that seems super complicated. And who's going to do the measuring?
It's the applicant who has to do it. They're motivated.
You have to have an engineer come out and do the...
A lot of times, I think the code officer gets out the aerial photo and just kind of, you know...
But has the town basically done that for most neighborhoods in town already?
No, we only do it when someone wants a building permit and they're adjacent to an RP1 wetland and they look like they could benefit from getting their buffer reduced from 250 feet to 100 feet. It's the only time it happens. It doesn't happen that often.
I mean, Google Earth will tell you. Just pick a picture of your house and measure it off against there, take a...
Lot size is already a tax, part of the tax record. It's an easy...
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Lot size is part of the tax record. It's an easily accessible number.
That's true.
It's on the real estate flyer. I think we also want to avoid, a situation where someone buys a house intending for it to be a short-term rental, and then they can't do it because they learn about this, you know, complex measurement technique. Okay. So it seems like we want it to be really transparent.
All right. I have a list here. I think it's just shy of 50 rentals, and we know there are rentals out there that we don't have on our list. But the lot sizes are, what I was asked to do by a counselor was to try to put them in neighborhood clusters. So this is a little contrived, but we called the Shore Road North cluster, which is kind of the Keys Lane area, but it includes Shore Road. And the lot sizes there are 47,000, 8,700, 32,000, 9,300, 42,300, 23,600, 76,200. The average of that cluster is 34,344. So all of those properties would be above the magic 30,000 number. Then what I called the Pond Cove cluster, which is basically the Lawson Road neighborhood, we have David Ginn's property at 24,000. That's one of the properties on Seabarn Road. 13 Lawson at 14,400. 31 Lawson at 24,500. And then we have three on Shore Road that are on two on a 120,000 square foot lot and one on a 9,000 square foot lot. So all of those would fall under the 30,000. We have the Dunham Cottage, which is 19,253, so that would fall under 30,000. I don't have the People's Cove's numbers because when this data was collected, they hadn't subdivided yet, but I know that most of those lots are under the 30,000. A lot of them are in the 18,000 range. Then what we called the Midcoast Cluster, which is just two, one on Surfside, one in Running Tide Road. The Surfside is 14,376, and then the Running Tide Road lot is 36,000. So that one would not be under 30,000. Then we end up with the Two Lights Cluster, which is Kettle Cove Road and Two Lights Road. We have the Huebner's property on a 10,000 square foot lot, so they're well below 30,000. Another lot on Kettle Cove Road, which is 20,000. Then we've got a big lot, 90,000 on Two Lights Road, an even bigger lot on Two Lights Road at 126,000. And we've got some unknown ones that may fall underneath the 30,000. And then the rest of them are all way, way above. Charles Jordan Road, we have, 435,000 square foot lots, very large lots. That's the Sprague Corporation. And then we have a couple of stray lots that are inland, which is unusual. Most of the rentals are on the coast. But we've got 84,000, 174,000, 435,000. So, we've got some very big lots here.
Maureen, do you think we ought to also apply the seven-day thing to the lot size?
If you wanted to do that, we could certainly structure it that way.
Yeah, it makes a certain amount of sense to me, because when we get into that type of a property, it just seems like a lot of this stuff does sort of fall by the wayside. I mean, I would be in favor of that, I guess.
You don't have a workshop scheduled for July, so if you don't find a way to wrap this up tonight, you're looking at bringing it back for your regular meeting in July or August.
I think we can wrap it up tonight. I don't think it's that complicated.
So the question is, do we want to use 30,000 square feet? And if we do, what do we want to apply to it? The maximum of 10 tenants? And Peter just suggested the seven-day rental, minimum rental period. And if that's...
Do you want to lower the number of tenants on small lot?
May I ask a question?
Yes.
How many people want to reinstitute some kind of lower lot size requirement?
I can do it, but I have a question on the 30,000.
Okay, so we're definitely somewhere. That's good. How many people think that putting it just above number 6 on 14 is the right place for it?
I do, assuming I understand the sanitary waste disposal provision, because I think we need...
Let's assume we can make you understand.
I think we need to leave in here the concept that the number of tenants you have is a factor of the adequacy of your sanitary waste, whether it's on sewer or on septic. And whatever the size of your lot, you are, regardless of lot size, yeah, you're limited by the sanitary waste capacity.
If you insert this limit right above number 6,
yep,
it has no impact on the sanitary waste. The whatever you've agreed to the sanitary waste still applies to everything.
Okay.
Okay? And this inserting of a limit is everything above where you insert it applies to everybody, and everything below only applies to certain things.
Okay.
So right now, how many people are willing to tighten up number 6 to make it fewer people? Okay, that's one.
For
two,
smaller
three.
Lots?
Yes. Yep. Because if you don't have enough people who are willing to tighten that up, there's no point in inserting the 30,000 square feet unless you are motivated to grant relief to people on larger lots.
I'm motivated in both directions.
Okay. Well, you are. Are there three other people?
What is somebody putting forth as a number?
I had a question on that. I think I heard in the Keys area, it was 34,000 was the average, and on Surfside there was 36,000. So I'm wondering if we could bump it to 40,000, and we would capture those two neighborhoods.
You would capture most of the properties in those neighborhoods even at 30, but 40 is fine too.
I'm all for 1 acre. I think it's a nice round number.
Which is how many thousand?
Around 40.
Usually we use 40,000. An acre is 43,560 square feet. But the convention in the ordinance is to round it to 40. So you use numbers like 40, 80.
So it sounds like we have two numbers out there. We're going to make some kind of division either at 30 or 40. So let's do a show of hands. How many people would make the division at 40? How many people would make it at 30? So it looks like we make it at 30. Okay, on lots in excess of 30,000 square feet, let's talk about what kind of restrictions would apply to lots in excess of 30,000 square feet other than those imposed by septic. And the ones imposed by septic or by sanitary waste are only imposed on tenants and not on guests, correct?
Can I shorten that? I'm assuming that starting on page 13 under standards, one, paragraph 1, paragraph 2, paragraph 3, paragraph 4, and paragraph 5 would apply to all properties.
Everybody, correct.
Everybody. So...
But if you had a very large house on a larger lot so that you could have more than 10 tenants, do we want to restrict that? We want to have a maximum number of tenants if the sanitary waste capacity would allow it.
I don't think so. No. I think if you have the number of bedrooms and the number and the sanitary capacity...
That should do it.
That should do it, yeah.
Okay, what about for guests? Do we want to impose any restriction on guests for a lot in excess of 30,000 square feet? No bus rule applies.
Right, so, so that person who wanted to have the 60-person wedding could do it on those other properties. And I'm not saying that's good or bad, I just want to, I'm testing your...
We still have the parking, but the parking doesn't deal with guests, does it?
No, the parking deals with guests, but if you have a big enough lot, you can
But you could, yeah, you could still, you know, you could contract with the town to have your overflow and have the valet shuttle them back and forth, and...
I guess I'd be inclined to have some limit on guests on short-term rentals, even on the larger lots.
Lane, doesn't, if number 4 is parking, and if that's going to apply to all...
That applies to all of them.
All short-term rentals.
But remember, what number 4 says is you have to provide parking. It doesn't put a cap on how much parking you have to provide. Okay, so if you wanted to, you know, if you have a 40,000 square foot lot and you want to rent out your property for a 60-person wedding, and you can fit 10 cars on your property, and then you can contract with the town to park the rest of them behind town hall, you can still do it.
Right.
What if we say the maximum number of guests shall not exceed the maximum number of permitted tenants? Just as a rough thing.
I'm for that.
What about these large properties? A couple of speakers said they had nonprofit.
But there weren't a lot of sleepovers on those. Pardon? I mean, yeah, one of them was, I mean, they were having, it was their own event.
Yeah.
You know, the graduation party. My kid graduated and we had all these people over. Well, that's not a short-term rental.
Oh, no, understood. I took them.
And then there were, like, the beach to beach and thing. That's not a short-term rental. They're just holding an event on their property.
Hosting something.
They're not having people sleeping over and...
Week after week after week.
It doesn't apply to their own event.
Yeah, yeah, that's, but I know what you're saying. You're asking about these kind of big events that people were concerned about. And this is, I don't think this is regulating those.
Okay. I have one question. If you can't invoke no parking or no noise, who polices this? I mean, it's the same sort of thing. You can't make noise because you could call the police and they could stop it. Now you end up with all these things and nobody to enforce it.
You can't make noise under the current noise ordinance. There's a nuisance ordinance, and if you get too loud, your neighbors can call the police, and they can apply the provisions under the current
Right, but
nuisance
it appears
ordinance.
That it's not happening.
But they're not calling the police about it.
Okay, so now you have this.
No, and that's a generic comment. Clearly, some people did call, and I mean, it's just overall what we're hearing from people is that they're uncomfortable when the bride knocks on the door at 10 o'clock at night saying, can I leave the music on?
Right.
You know, I'm just sort of completely
coming over to my side.
If there's a violation and anyone is affected by it, a neighbor, they call the code enforcement officer and you get away with it once. And after that, the code enforcement officer can pull your permit. And he has the right to pull the permit for violations of the conditions of the permit. So it's kind of like a one bite rule for a dog. They get a free bite.
I phone up. My da-da-da-da is in... doing something that's not in favor on the thing here. Now, I'm the court and the judge, and I've convicted all in one. It's my word against who? I mean, now I turn around.
You can document it, you can take pictures, you can do all the other things. You get the code enforcement officer out there. There are lots of ways to document what goes on a property. And that's always a question about enforcement when you don't have somebody standing right there. And ultimately, you can deny the permit. And I think what this would keep from happening is a wedding business on a lot of 35,000 square feet that happens to be on the ocean. And I think, to me, that's what people were talking about really being a problem.
I can see your point. I don't totally agree with it, but I can see your point.
It's not perfect.
Okay, the suggestion was that we limit the number of guests to
the maximum number of tenants, which is a function of sanitary waste capacity. It's an easy
and number of bedrooms. Yeah, there's different things, but anyway, it's whatever you got, whatever you could acquire in 1 through 5 for tenants, you can have that many number again for guests.
But only on lots over 30,000.
Right.
Do we issue have people calculate all this on the when
it's
we
in
go?
There.
But yes,
it's
I understand,
actually,
but
it's
yeah,
there.
Still a complicated thing.
It's
for
not
us.
That complicated. I mean,
to me that seems. I mean,
seems
it seems to be restricting. It seems to be restricting all properties, and so the 30,000 square foot thing becomes moot.
Well, one of the problems we had was we had before said that if you had so many tenants, then you could have that many number again for guests. And there are some rentals out there that are only 2 bedrooms. And some people were saying, well, you know, if I rent my 2-bedroom house out and we want to have a Thanksgiving dinner and have 2 sets of parents, we're kind of stuck. So that's why we went to the 10 guests, because that actually helped out the little places. We could say, we could set a number and say, but not to
No.
I think you need to set it just a number. You just come up with a flat number. Number of tenants plus guests are another 10 or another 20.
Sorry, here's your proposal. 6 to 8 tenants maximum, 30,000 square feet and under, and we leave it the way it is for bigger lots.
Leave it the way it is, as in unregulated?
No. 10 plus 10.
I'm sorry?
10 plus 10.
10 plus 10. I think that's more restrictive than we need to be. If you have a 6-bedroom house, I would think you ought to be able to have 12 tenants if you have a big enough lot.
Right.
We're saying you can have as many tenants. You're not limiting the tenants on the above. In excess of 30,000, you can have as many tenants as you can cram in under the first 5 standards. And then you can have an additional 15 guests.
17.
Do we care?
I don't see why would we limit it on the lots over 30,000?
Because 12 people is a lot of people on 3/4 acre.
It's the big weddings, Joe, if you care about that.
The other option is to raise the number of square feet.
And I'm concerned that this is growing. We're talking about Lawson right now. But I live in a very crowded residential neighborhood, and my lot's greater than 30,000. So they're out there, and that's why I do think we need limits, and that's why I feel we should have a limit. They're growing. They're coming inland.
So we could have a 20 to 30,000 limit, and an above 30,000 limit, and an under 20,000 limit. We could chop it finer.
You could.
Well, you could have a under 30,000 and a between 30 and 60,000. And I'm just throwing out numbers.
Yeah, we could.
Yeah.
Or 40 and 80.
But that, I mean,
it's the size of a single family.
What if you did say, okay, if you have a conforming lot in the RA district, that's 80,000 square feet, there's no limit on the number of guests.
And non-conforming would be?
All right, I'm just, let's take it one step at a time.
That's a logical.
So conforming lot would be the threshold for unlimited?
In the RA district, a conforming lot is 80,000 square feet. So if you have 80,000 square feet of more, you have no limit on the number of guests.
I buy it.
One.
I could see that, that's a large lot.
That would mean someone could conduct a wedding business on an 80,000 square feet foot lot in an RA district, and I find that troublesome.
Okay, that's a no.
But what about clusters where the house, the house lots are 32?
Then they couldn't, they, all right, we're only talking, I'm trying to, it's 10, 28.
I know, and I still have stuff to do.
I'm trying to, so. No?
It's a no.
No.
So, yeah, single-family neighborhoods, it should be single-family size, like somebody mentioned earlier. I think that's really great rationale.
But what that, what you've just figured out is even if it's a big lot, you want a limit on how many people can be on it.
Yeah, because big lots are in single-family neighborhoods.
So that's, you've reached some conclusion here.
See, okay. I think the problem is if, Elaine, if you don't want wedding business, you have to say that's a non-allowable use. I don't think you're going to...
It's not with events, an events business.
But conducting an event business off the property, I think, is, would just take you right out of the use.
Actually, that hasn't been the finding of the code enforcement officer.
No, that's...
Really?
No.
What do we define as a business? Is it something you spend more than half of your time at?
All I can tell you is that the code officer's position, and he's put it in memo, so I'm not, you know, speaking him, is that holding a wedding is something that a single-family homeowner can do. Therefore, doing
holding
it...
Holding a wedding for profit?
Wait. Holding you, your daughter or son wants to get married, you host it at your home, or they have a graduation party, or 50th anniversaries. That's the typical kind of use that you can have happen at a single-family home. Therefore, he considers that use permitted.
Right.
Now, we could write something that says that if you're holding events at your home and you're charging to hold that event at your home, and it's not to raise money for a nonprofit, then it's not a use that's considered consistent with a single family. And we could try to get into that. We're not going to get it done tonight.
How about, so that we can move this on to the council who gets to go through this all over again, how about if we do 30,000 square feet and 15 guests, and under 30,000 square feet, eight guests. The number of tenants is limited by the maximum of maybe eight and eight.
Eight plus eight.
Just to throw something out.
Maximum number of tenants, eight in a small lot?
Yeah,
under eight tenants, subject to septic, which could make it less.
Sure.
But in the smaller lots, eight tenants and eight guests for short-term rentals.
Better than what we have.
Okay, that's two.
I don't know.
Sure.
Three.
Just to get it to the next stage.
Four to the next.
Yeah, there.
Goodbye.
Okay, so number six, I'm going to change. Number six, which is on page 14, line 9. On line 11, it's going to say a maximum of eight tenants. And line 12, and number of guests is going to be limited to eight. And then somewhere in line 8, I'm going to put a new paragraph that says for lots in less than 30,000 square feet, that's what the limit of intensity shall apply. And then above line 8, I'm going to say for lots greater than 30,000 square feet, I'm going to take number 6 and say the same thing, except the number of tenants is going to be 10, and the number of guests is going to be 15.
Now, the number of tenants is not 10. The number of tenants is determined solely by...
No limit on tenants.
No limit on tenants.
Not two tenants per bedroom?
Well, two tenants per bedroom, but that happens
elsewhere. You get that through the septic system, so there would not be any other limit. It would be driven by your capacity.
What did you say, Kat?
Wait, it should be driven by bedrooms.
15 guests.
15.
Go back to...
Making 25, and that's any size place. You're saying 25.
No, it applies to both. It doesn't say septic. It's sanitary waste, which is septic and sewer. That's what I was trying to figure out earlier.
If it's a short permit.
Maureen, you repeat them.
So does everybody agree with that? Because I'm not so sure they all understand.
Okay, so what would happen...
Okay, let's all listen to Maureen here.
Okay, so we're on page 14. starting on line 8, we're going to have a new sentence that says, for lots that are greater than 30,000 square feet, they're limited to no more than 15 guests.
How about just for clarification purposes, we cross-reference, the maximum number of tenants shall be determined by the earlier provision, so it's clear that we're not intending not to have a max, shall be determined by the sanitary waste disposal provision.
Okay, well...
And just to make the two parallel.
As allowed by the prior standards.
Right.
The maximum allowed, allowed per prior standards.
Right.
So if you're on the public septic, I mean, that's...
But just let's roll with it for a minute, and then you can tell me what's wrong.
I just want to make sure I understood.
So that means that if you've got a six-bedroom house, and you're on public sewer, or you've got a big septic system, and you've got plenty of space for parking, you can have 12 tenants, and you can have 15 guests. And that's...
Less than 30,000?
And then there will be another line after that that's for properties that are 30,000 square feet or less. The short-term rental shall have no more than...
8 to 9.
A maximum of 8 tenants, and the number of guests shall, at any one time, shall also be limited to 8.
Yep.
So you say a maximum people that can occupy less than 30,000 is 16.
Correct.
And a maximum people is 27 for greater than 30.
Yes.
I think now...
It wouldn't be necessarily 27.
It's the maximum number of guests would be 15, and whatever else you can... I mean, someone may build a 10-bedroom house.
All right, okay.
Now we're back to our own old problem, though, where we have a different standard for a house that's on sewer than that's on septic.
Yes, we do.
So I have a problem.
Does anybody else have a problem with that?
No.
No.
Okay. So are there 4 people that can live with this? No limit on tenants. And 15 guests for the above 30,000 square feet, and then 8 tenants plus 8 guests for the 30,000 and less.
Who can live with that?
I'd rather limit the tenants, but...
1, 2, 3.
I'll live with it, yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so we can go with that.
Do we want the 7-day thing to be not apply to the over 30,000, or should...
I can't hear you.
Do we want the 7-day thing to not apply to over 30,000, or is that...
That's a good question. Do you?
I do. I want it to apply.
Because the way you've drafted it now, we've changed 7 so that any short-term rental has to be minimum 7.
You'd have to further accept it, or you'd have to tweak
right.
it.
So are there 4 people that want to go to allow the people on more than 30,000 square feet to be able to rent for a minimum of 3 days?
How about 5?
7. 3.5. I like 7.
72 hours.
I would be in favor of 7 applying to all.
Yeah, you don't have the numbers for 5.
Okay.
Done.
I'm outvoted. So it's 7 applying to everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, I think we're at the end.
Now, do you want to, as a board, make any more generic recommendation about the nuisance ordinance?
I think it would be appropriate to point out that the public has suggested that tighter and more uniformly enforced nuisance regulations might help address some of these problems, but
yeah.
They're beyond the purview.
The planning board recommends you review the nuisance ordinance.
Absolutely.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. Sorry, but...
We can recommend it.
Yeah.
Sure. But I would think it would be clear in addition to, not as an alternative to.
I'm hearing it as an addition.
Yeah.
The planning board also recommends.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and then there was a draft report that I prepared. I have to ask, are there things that the board would like to, other than the adjustments I need to make based on what changes you've come up with, are you generally satisfied that the report reflects what you want it to say to the council?
I guess the other thing I would like to reflect back to the council is that this draft includes many compromises on which the planning board was divided. It's a consensus draft, but that...
What I wrote on page 3, which, you know, can use some wordsmithing, yeah, is the planning board recommendation was reviewed in detail and the final product is a compromise arrived at by a majority of the planning board.
Yeah, but they, we should state that it's after listening to a lot of input from a lot of people.
Okay.
Without that, I mean, I would have, I did change my mind over a number of things when listening to
listening to a lot.
It's actually a series of compromises.
Sorry?
I think it's a series of compromises.
Series,
it's not
yes.
one compromise.
I can say individual board members, all board members individually made compromises to come up with this consensus document.
Excellent. Yeah, that works. And anyone who wants to submit a dissenting opinion, feel free.
Get shot at the door, yeah.
It's assigned to attend all ordinance committee.
Well, the other thing I would say quite seriously, because I know there's some people on the planning board who are very unhappy, who feel that they've compromised on everything. And I acknowledge that that has happened. And the planning board is going to be asked to go to the ordinance committee meeting and explain what we've done. And I intend to do that, but it would not in the least bit concern me if other people who are members of the planning board wanted to individually express the fact that they are not happy where we ended up. I don't think this is something where on some kind of a board, it's sort of, once we've made our decision, we all got to rally behind it. I actually don't feel that way on this. So anyone who would like to continue to express your dissent, since we are only one step in the process, I would encourage you to do that.
And if you recommend this tonight, I can even tell you the date of that ordinance committee meeting.
Okay. So with that, does anyone want to venture to make a motion?
I will.
Who was that?
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the materials and the facts presented, the planning board recommends the short-term rental amendments to the town council for consideration.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Joe, second. Okay, any further discussion?
I just want to make sure we're, when you say recommends the amendments, we're talking about this consensus
document. The consensus document based on tonight's discussion. Yes.
Any further discussion? All in favor? All right. Liza, put your hand up.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, okay, so that's a unanimous recommendation. Move it on.
I'm going to make these changes and send them to you.
Okay.
So that you can make sure that I did what I was supposed to do.
Okay.
Okay.
And anybody else? How about if you email everyone when you have them so if anybody else would like them?
But you can't discuss it. So if
no.
If I'll email it to everyone, but if you think something's wrong, you just have to write back to me that says you did that wrong, and then I will work with Elaine to get a document that Elaine approves of. Is that fair?
That works.
Technical comments, you mean? You'll take technical comments, not substantive.
Always.
Okay, so what is the date of that ordinance meeting?
It's the same morning as your July planning board meeting. So I believe the meeting is July 17th, so it's 8 a.m. on July 17th.
Oh, 8 a.m.
When that agenda goes out, I will copy all of you on it so that...
So this will go to the ordinance committee before it goes back to the council?
No, because you've made your vote tonight,
right.
I will have your recommendation submitted to the council by the end of this month. And because it's going to be submitted at the end of this month, it's very likely that it'll end up on the July 9th town council agenda.
Okay.
And so the assumption, we haven't confirmed yet, but the assumption is, one, that the council will put it on their July agenda, and two, that their action will be to refer it to the ordinance committee. And if they do that, the ordinance committee has already picked a date, and I gave you the wrong date. I said it was the 17th, but it's really July 31st. I apologize, but it's 8 a.m., and I will send that out.
Our meeting is July 31st?
No, the ordinance committee has two, they've scheduled two ordinance committee meetings in July, and the second one was, they were holding it for the short-term rental amendments if this was moving forward.
And we do not make a presentation at the town council meeting?
You actually are required to go to the town council meeting. The presentation at the council meeting is on the short side. They really are, you're there more to answer questions. And then the ordinance committee is much more free-flowing. You're sitting at the table with them, and...
Are you going to recommend a bigger room?
The short-term rental meetings have always been in a bigger room.
Okay, so July 9th and July 31st for anyone who wants to continue to watch this dialogue. I believe that's the last item on our agenda. Thank you, everyone, for your patience, whether you're here or watching us at home. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion we adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. We stand adjourned. Thank you.
I think we covered it.